Broadcasting live from WTMH Radio Studios, it's the Slapstick Comedy Radio Show, covering all things funny, where you are guaranteed to get a good laugh to the abs, with your hosts, Damon M. Cherry, Misha, and Stephen G.
Testing 1 2 1 2 1 2. Is this thing on?
Check 1 2. Can you hear me?
Check 1 2.
All right. I can hear you. Everything's good. What's going on? This is your boy Damon M. Cherry. You are tuned in.
Yes, indeed.
To the first ever. Well, I can't say the first ever. This had to be the
season two.
Okay. Yeah. Of Slapstick Comedy Radio Show.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's what's up, man. And we're gonna do this thing each and every Thursday from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. live right here at WTMHradio.com, hoping to venture out into further ventures. And you will be able to catch the podcast on Anchor and all this outlets that they do, which we're going to put up tonight. And you got the SoundCloud page, right?
Got the SoundCloud.
So we'll be up on SoundCloud and all that, man. And we're going through COVID right now, but you know, we found our way to get back into something, and we're about to jump this thing off. So you know, this is a show that's about comedy and about comedians. And I'm gonna let the founder and owner and originator of Slapstick with a K, Misha. I think we gotta add something to your name, Misha, because you know, like most radio personalities, they always got something like Misha D.
You think I need to do all that,
yeah,
though?
You need Misha.
Them be 20-year-old girls. Not seasoned women like herself.
I'm Misha.
But when I say your name, look, he's got Stephen G. You know
what
I'm saying?
Yeah.
You need something. We got to come up with something like Lady Misha or something.
Mm. Well, I was in my 20s when Stephen G was born, you know.
But then you're still 50 and it's still going.
It is. Going strong.
Right. So, like I said, Damon M. Cherry. So I didn't want to say your government name. I didn't know if you want your government out there yet. So that's why. You know what I'm saying? We get with Lady M or something. We got to come up with something.
Not no lady, nothing.
Okay.
We don't scratch that.
Well, what about young ladies?
No, not that.
Everybody going with boss lady. This girl told me, what's your name? She said, boss lady. I said, well, I won't be saying that. I know your mama didn't name you boss lady. She did not. Mama named you Cindy. I'm going to call you Cindy.
And the only way I'm calling you boss lady is if you give me that extra $600 that all these people getting.
I'm sick of it.
Me too.
Unemployment. I'm already working my ass off.
Man.
For $150 less a week, you know what I'm saying? What I was getting, but it's all good though. But that's what's up. So I'm gonna let Misha tell you a little bit about Slapstick, how she got this thing going, and
why we're all here.
Right. Exactly.
Yep. So I want to start off by saying I got my day ones. That is Stephen G and Damon M. Cherry. They have been with me since day one. I started Slapstick. We started going hard back in like 2008.
I think I came around day two.
No, you day one. I still consider you day one. Day one.
It was the evening.
Because right when I started taking off, y'all was there. Y'all have always been there for me. So right, I'm thankful for that.
Yes,
so
indeed.
Now that we're working on some new stuff, got the day ones back, and we're about to just take it to the next level. We got some surprises. We're not going to tell y'all what's going to happen, what's going to come out of this.
Can't do that.
No, not at all. Not yet.
Can't give it away yet.
It's going to be a big surprise. We're going to the next level. Right now, we got the blog kicked off. You can check out the blog on www.slapstickcomedy.wordpress.com. Check out the website at www.comedyslaps.com.
And yeah, and right now, you can check us out live. We are live on YouTube, so you can go to YouTube. You go on Facebook, George Quinn, WTMH Live on Facebook. Or you can go to Damon M. Cherry right now and share that watch party, joining that watch party that we're in. So, you know, we just going to kick it off. And this is my man, Stephen G. What's going on, fam?
Great.
We've been radio since we first put WTMH together.
Yes, man. Indeed. So that's here. Quite a while ago. Everybody's right. Been jumping in and getting on the bandwagon since then. But, hey,
right.
You know.
And you want to know what I want to say about us three coming together right now? Even though we've been cool forever, day one, but we had our times when we was apart.
Sure.
But now we done came back together.
We came back together.
Always been cool, you know what I'm saying? No beefs, no problems, no nothing. So,
we've always kept in touch.
Right.
No
always.
Beefs, no egos, no
right.
None of that.
So we're gonna make this thing jump off, man.
That's
we're gonna
right.
make this thing jump off. So how y'all been dealing with the COVID? Y'all good?
I'm cool. I do not mind staying home. I got plenty of things to do at my house.
No family members came down with it? No.
I'm ready for my son to get the freak out. I'm ready for him to go. And then he tells me last week, Mom, I'm going to be leaving. I'm about to buy my ticket. I'm like, cool.
He in Arizona, right?
They shut down. I'm salty.
That's what I was about to say. It's one of the biggest spikes out there.
Right? Oh, yeah. Salty. Definitely.
Yeah, he's here for another 5 months. I'm not going to get used to that.
Don't remind me.
Yeah, everybody quarantining.
Right. Yeah. So what y'all been doing through this quarantine?
Weed, water, and weights.
Weed, water, and weights. Okay, the three W's.
You know, the three W's, working out a little bit, and getting the water on, and, you know, you can't do anything but prepare for shows because they've canceled everything. But as we speak, I'm getting calls. I got 3, 4, 5 shows they're calling. So if everyone can stay at home and let this thing die down, we can get back to normal because the comics are hurting. And I feel for all the comics because we are really hurting and we need to get back to work. So the quicker everyone can just come together and stay inside and have a consorted effort to do that or make a consorted effort to do that, and then wear a face mask when you are out, maybe we can get back to normal sooner than later.
Hey, man, we might as well just go on, just take 2020 and just ball it up like a piece of paper and just throw it in the trash can.
And try again.
Try again in 2021. But until, like we were saying earlier, before when you first got in, we need to go and just shut everything on down for about 2 months. Just shut it down.
Yeah, shut it down.
And just go and give me about $6,000-$7,000. Let me pay my rent for these months off, and then let me jack off the rest.
I'm down.
Let me do what I want to with the rest.
Yep, it's all about cooperation right now. That's what we need.
Right.
So we can get this going.
So that's right.
Y'all don't know nobody came down with it or had it?
No. I don't know anyone personally. Yeah, no.
I think I had it back in November, man.
I do too.
I think I had it back in November. Mm-hmm. And to be honest with you, man, I go on my job, I go in 4 nursing homes every day, but I'm masked up. But I go in 4 nursing homes. I think I done had it 4 or 5 times since then.
Yeah, you may have. You may be a carrier. Right. You know, but show asymptomatic.
I done killed about 8 people.
Yeah. You didn't send 8 people to the hospital just passing you up. Like, how you doing? They sick tomorrow. That damn Jerry.
That's why I'm glad I don't have to go anywhere. Right. Just stay home and get it done.
But it's been good, man. I had an uncle. He thought he came down when he quit drinking, and, you know, he started having, like, relapses from drinking. Come to find out, this nigga had cognac. 25.
He didn't have COVID. He had cognac. With no chaser.
Right. So, Other than that, man, actually, Raven here at the studio, he had it. He was in the hospital for almost 2 weeks.
Yeah, I do know someone that had it and died. The whole family ended up in the hospital. Ooh. The dad died. Wow. And, yeah. So now, because of that, I actually take it serious. And after he died, I told my son, I said, okay, we're going to start wearing our mask from here on out.
So what's your mask game like? You on a regular hospital mask? And you got
well, you know what? I
you
lucked
got,
up.
You got your designer mask.
I do have a designer mask. However, I went to the grocery store and some man walked up to me. He said, where's your mask? And it pissed me off because I'm like, who is he talking to?
He put his gun out on you, did he?
Yeah, I was.
Man, you know, white people quickly pull their gun out of you.
I was
my
ready.
Goodness.
But that's the other thing. He was a black man, so I said, okay. I'm going to listen to him. At first, I thought he was trying to hit on me, but I said, nah. But he ended up giving me 10 free masks, and they're super nice masks, so I'm sporting.
Wow. Well,
what about you, Steven?
It's a nice gesture.
Well, I saw you come in with the Dr. Quinn medical.
Oh,
medical.
I see it over there.
Yeah, well, I have to be careful. Like I said, I got shows coming up. I don't want to get anybody sick, and I don't want to get sick myself. And I'm just trying to be safe, like everybody else. You know, I mean, I personally believe that somebody made this thing in a culture dish. I don't care if it's here in the United States, in China, in Wuhan, or wherever, Huang, or wherever it originated from. But I do believe it's man-made. And
You ain't seen a video where they make those? Whatever, they had the Vietnamese people. They was in the shop making. They ain't got on no shoes, no shirts,
or nothing.
And the mask just coming off the little line, dropping on the floor.
Yeah,
I've seen that.
And just going all up under the table.
Yeah.
That's like, what made me say I don't want to wear a mask.
Yeah, I got. Well, you know, my mask game been A1 because, you know, I got over 15 different designer masks. You know what I'm saying? Like I could have worn a 5-8-7 mask to match this tonight, but I figure since we 3.5 feet apart from each other, here,
That's good enough.
It's all about trust right now.
Right, that's what it's all about, man. But yeah, you know what I'm saying? But, you know, Slapstick Radio, man, this is gonna be great. We're gonna do some great things, you know. We're gonna do it a little bit different than most comedy shows. Like, we're gonna almost make it like a radio show, but instead of hearing music, we're gonna play that comedy.
That's right.
Like it.
But now some of these jokes y'all might have heard before, but it don't matter, because it's the same as like if you listen to Kevin Hart station on Sirius XM, we bringing Sirius XM here to Columbus, Ohio, to the city. You know what I'm saying? So that's what's up. We just doing
for your listening pleasure.
For your listening pleasure. So that's what's up. Steven G, you said you got some shows coming up. Where you got some shows coming up?
I'll be in DeWitt in Indianapolis. Well, not Indianapolis, but Marion, Indiana.
Right.
Yeah, I'm there all the time. They love me in Indianapolis, in Indiana, period. But I'll be in Marion, Indiana. I'll be at the Kentucky Derby.
They cranked the Derby up. I heard.
Yeah. It's still on. It's back on September 3rd.
Okay.
I haven't heard anything, you know, contrary to that as of yet. So hopefully, you know, fingers crossed, that thing is still going. And then Chicago.
Okay, we'll
gotta be out there.
Well,
so
we praying for you, man. Hope you don't have a D.A. Hughley moment up on stage.
Well, I hope I don't pass out.
Right.
You know, or anything like that. I know DL, and I was feeling for him, you know, and that's unfortunate because as well, he was asymptomatic. He showed no symptoms,
right,
and then just pass out,
right,
you know, so that has got to scare every comic.
Right.
You get up there, you're exerting energy, you're sweating, the lights are on you. And I felt like passing out just from being a little buzzed on stage before.
Right.
So, man, come on.
But let me ask you this. As a comedian, do you think it was too early for him to be out there doing comedy? You think the comedy clubs, since they so tight-knit, that they still should be closed up?
Well,
I think that's the easiest way to get it.
I think the funny bones and things like you're right on top of each
right.
other. You are literally right on top of each other. Now, arenas or, say, other venues where you can probably space a little bit,
right,
or they have chairs that are already spaced out, you may can get away with that. But a comedy club per se, oh my God, you know how tight they're on top of each
yeah.
other.
Well, side by side.
Right. Now I'm gonna tell y'all this Sunday, since we talking about COVID, I was kind of in my feelings this Sunday because, as y'all know, I'm a 47-year-old dad.
Mm.
To have my first child at 47.
Imagine that.
This thing want to start working and want to start shooting at 47. About the dirt I did. It want to shoot off right at 47.
Mr. Uncle Daddy.
Right.
You got five names.
Grandpappy, Uncle Daddy.
Let's change that.
I'm the pappy. But nah, man, I was in my feelings because they dedicated my daughter at the church you go to, that the mother goes to, and it's a white church, man. And when I pulled up in the parking lot, man, I'm the only person on with a mask. I mean, it's a big, 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 big white church, like 400-500 people out of New Albany. I'm the only person in there with a mask on. They looking at me like I'm silly. But you want to bring this baby around all these people. Ain't nobody in here got no mask on.
I mean, you know.
But it was one of them situations where I really couldn't say nothing because.
You know, no, you couldn't. You were far outnumbered.
Right.
Far in New Albany at that.
Yeah. We don't know if you'd have got noosed or hung or anything out there, but.
But the pastor played it so safe. He didn't. He didn't even come in the room to do the dedication. He made a video.
Oh wow. I would have felt disrespected.
Now, you see how safe he was.
Right. He was good and safe. He back there telling, you know what I'm saying? Why he giving a speech about dedicating the baby and all that? I'm like, really?
He slingshotting communion in people's mouth and everything.
Man, I seen a dude get baptized, you know, because church. Well, since we've been on, you know, the COVID thing with church and all that, I'm a member of about 147 churches right now. I done joined 147 churches. You know, this one church, they baptized the dude. I don't know if y'all seen that, but they baptized him like that. They made him get in his own bathtub while they did the Facebook Live or whatever, and he baptized himself.
His own bathtub. Yeah,
he dipped himself.
Yeah.
I would have just stood there.
Yeah, it's good.
Ducked down. Came back up.
COVID and messed up.
Well, it's all about atonement. It's not about dipping in that water.
Right.
It's about atoning.
Right.
Now, are you going to atone? Are you going to live the same life? Or because that baptism didn't mean anything if
right.
if you're not.
It's just like my church. We've been doing the Lord's Supper at the house with like grape juice and where the pastor said an unsalted cracker because you want a pure body or whatever.
Uh-huh.
So, but I think I messed that up because I had cran grape And
yeah, Crane Great.
And has Worcester crackers.
You brought the wrong thing. for communion.
I don't know.
He had Cheez-Its. Yeah, boy, what are you doing with Cheez-Its in here? It's communion.
But that's what's up, man. We're gonna go into our first break right here. Then we're gonna come back with some trending topics and find out what's going on in the news. This your boy Demond M. Cherry,
Stephen G,
and I'm Misha.
And we are right here on Slapstick Comedy Radio.
Yes, indeed.
I'm one of those people that's so smart that I'm uncomfortable in this world. And I'm scared to live. I'm not scared to live, but it's scary out here. God damn. I know how flimsy this shit is. I can see through the. I can see the truth. There's an animal inside each and every one of you. It's not good. Shit is real. Listen, I was looking at the paper the other day. I'm not making this up. There's a serial rapist in Houston. There's nothing funny about serial rape, but what is noteworthy about this particular rapist is that all of his victims have been men. Enjoy your evening. I can't believe you clapped about that. It's a man raping men in Houston. That's the most gangster shit. So far, like 7 men have already come forward in the Houston area and reported this motherfucker, which means he must have raped thousands. That's a tough phone call for us to make. It's not like when you get raped, ladies. There's no society don't give a fuck about male rape. There's no hotline for us. If man get raped, you just gotta get up and walk that shit off. Huh? Got raped. Caught me slipping. You gotta take that shit to the grave. Couldn't even tell my wife some shit like that. Come home all disheveled and shit. Hey, where have you been? It's 3 o'clock in the morning. Out fucking another woman. Just go back to sleep, okay?
Don't you ever in your life take a black woman for granted in a goddamn relationship, okay? Don't you ever do that. Because when it comes to relationships, women is the slickest and the most cunning people ever, okay? Now, I'm going to let you in on something. A lot of times, you brothers, you ain't even in a relationship no more because women break up with you, don't even let you know that you broke up with. Women break up at least 3 months before you have any idea that you broke up with. You don't even know. Everybody know but you. You be walking around, people be patting you on the back like, you all right? Because it's going to be all right. And then they slick with the breakup, and they like they do it normal. They slick with it. See, women do what I call the monkey bar. See, a lot of times they tell you, I need to be by myself, but it ain't never about them being by themselves. It's always somebody else in the picture, and what they do is what I call the monkey bar. Now, you've been to the playground, and they got that little set where you swing from one bar to the other. Well, that's what women do to you. They hold on to your ass while they swing on over to another brother. Now, if you don't feel comfortable, they swing back to your ass. They monkey bar you, and this slick stuff. And let me tell you something, you got to watch it. This little signs that you got to watch for when you about to get monkey barred. Now, when you about to get monkey barred, you got to watch, because it's in poker, they call it tails. It's little indications how they going to play their hand. A lot of times, brothers don't see it. One of them you got to watch for is your woman mad all the time. I don't give a damn what you do or how simple the situation is. You come in the house, get a glass of water. She's like, see, that's what I'm talking about. I don't need no man just drinking my water. Oh, you know, oh, something got to change around here. I hate him. Oh, when she just leave. Oh, they take the extreme opposite way. They don't be mad at all. Don't nothing bother them. Everything you do, your phone could ring at 3 o'clock in the morning. The caller ID could say my other bitch, and she will not do a damn thing, cause she done already monkey barred your ass.
Yo! Let me hear all the fellas in the house bumping head. All right, y'all got some of y'all got a cold, but it's all right. Let me hear all the ladies in the house say hello. Oh, see, y'all ain't say it right. Y'all should say it like when your brother take y'all out, y'all find out he ain't got no money, be like, hello. Look in your other pocket. I swear. I gotta ask the fellas, I need the fellas to help me out, right? This is what I need to do. This Mike Tyson case thing is throwing me off. And I need to know if the fellas will help me. If you want to help me through this case, I want to hear all y'all bark. Help me, fellas. Right, let's analyze the case. Mike Tyson calls the honey from the hotel room 2 o'clock in the morning. Is that or is that not a booty call? Can you help me? Okay, all right, right. Now, women know booty calls. They're usually late. Ladies know when that shit kind of be laying in bed like. Who calling me? She ain't even have to go. And what do honeys usually do, fellas, when they want to give you the booty? What they do? Always bring that ugly girlfriend to block. What? I mean, what does she expect from Mike Tyson? He called her from the hotel room. Hello. Hey, Mike. How you doing? Yeah, I saw you earlier today. I swear, you're beautiful, I swear. Why don't you come to my hotel room and play Scrabble? I swear, we just play Scrabble. Give me a break. Every brother in here done made a booty call. How many times you been in the crib on a Friday night chilling? Saying to yourself, Ted, who can I call? You go to your Rolodex. Vanessa. Too many kids. Stacy. Damn, owe her money. Call Kim. Be praying she home too. Hello. Yes. What's up, Kim? How you doing? I'm all right. Yo, I was just thinking about you, little baby. What you doing? Nothing. I'm kind of tired. You know, I went shopping today. I am so tired. I'm already in the bed. You in the bed? All right, well, check it out. Wait a minute, check it out. Why don't you come by? Come on, for real. Why don't you just slide on by? Maybe we could, like, make a movie. I mean, watch a movie or some shit like that. I am so tired. I mean, I don't know if I could come out tonight. Yo, come on. How long could it take you to get over here, bro? 5 minutes, I guess. I don't know. Just let me throw something on, okay? I'm coming, all right? Don't play. You coming? Don't fuck around. I'm serious. You coming, though, right? Yes, I'm coming. All right, I'll see you in a few minutes, all right? You coming? All right, I'll see you in a few minutes. Go to the shower. Walk by the mirror. I'm in the hat. My booty on the way. Every time a car roll by the window, you hit the shape. Where's the booty? Oh, shit. Where is my booty? I know my booty's on the way. Shit. 10 minutes later, doorbell ring. Boom, boom. You like, ah. Roll to the door. What's up, Kim? Why you bring your girl? That's fucked up. Well, she was up and I didn't know, you know. She was just up and I didn't want to come by myself. And the ugly girlfriend always got something to say, don't she, right?
How long y'all gonna be?
Go sit your ass in the car and shut up. Seriously, man, sex make you do crazy shit. And I'll tell you this, right? Everybody here remembers the best sex they had. You will never forget the best shit you had. You know what I'm talking about. How many times have you been driving and shit, right? You be driving, and all of a sudden you be like, oh, shit. She gonna get a booty call tonight.
That's right. We are back right here at WTMHRadio.com. It is Slapstick.
Black and we're back.
Slapstick Radio. It's your boy, Damon M. Cherry.
I'm Stephen G.
She's Lady Misha.
And I am.
She's over there busy on the computer.
But that's what's up, man. We hope y'all enjoyed the comedy break, man. You know what I'm saying? We came back with some throwback comedy right there for you.
Bill Bellamy.
My man, Bill Bellamy. Shout out to Bill Bellamy.
Shout out to Bill Bellamy.
His crew, the Jay Reed, D-Lay, Ali Sadiq, and all them, and the fam, you know what I'm saying? And they bodyguard E, man. That's one of the coolest bodyguards I've hung out with, man, for real. I know him as E with glasses.
Seen Bill Bellamy's brother? They look like twins.
I've never seen
his just brother. Alike. Really? They look just alike. Seriously.
But are they actually twins?
Yeah. No, they aren't. I asked Bill where they. He was like, nah. But, but they look just alike.
Well, hell, I look like my brother. But we ain't twins. You look like your brother.
Well, yeah. 6'1" and I'm 5'7", but yeah.
But that's what's up, man. We are back and we are going to get into our trending topics. And I think I'm gonna start off before I get into the first segment, which would be my segment, which I call What Is News. But since we're in the trending topics, let's talk about this COVID thing. We were just talking about COVID. I'm gonna give y'all some statistics about COVID. That more people need to start paying more close attention to, especially here in the United States. And I will give a semi, I guess I give the hamburger patty hand clap.
To DeWine. Yeah. You know, Governor DeWine, he's doing a good job.
He's doing his thing, man, you know, but he still need to go and shut everything down and shut it down for a minute.
We really reopened too fast.
Too fast.
For me. But we really did.
That still was your 45 thing, Donald Trump.
He's forcing everybody to do so. Right.
But Stephen, when do you think it was a good time to open? What's realistic to you?
What's realistic? I think realistically we should have been on the lockdown for about 3 months.
Right.
And
like September-ish?
And then look at the numbers.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And if they hadn't spiked, then talk about reopening the country back up.
Yeah. Right.
If not, then we have to stay on the lockdown.
Mm-hmm. Right. I think a lot of people now, the survival rate is a little bit better now because they're not throwing everybody straight on that respirator.
Once you
made the respirator,
it was done. It was a wrap.
It was a wrap.
It really was.
So now they're saying they're not putting. And the craziest thing about it is they're saying the easiest way most people make it through is just land them on their freaking stomach. Dog. They flip you over on your stomach so you can breathe. So you can breathe. Right. Yeah, as far as globally, the numbers are spiked across the world. As far as in Africa, there's 410,744 cases, 7,559 deaths. Now they got the lowest death rate of everywhere. Yeah, so I don't know what they're doing in Africa.
What, per capita?
Per capita. Yeah.
Okay.
So I don't know. I don't know if it's the heat over there. That 100.
Probably.
That 305 degrees.
Well, it's pretty hot here. Yeah. I mean, if a black person went outside today and stayed outside for about 20 minutes, you would have turned into bacon grease. Right.
But in those foreign countries, it's a different kind of hot over
yeah,
there.
Right. It is.
Because I talked to my homegirl in Turkey. I said, "What's going on with the cases over there?" She said, "Only two people got it."
Wow.
Yeah, but it's hot. Over there.
Hot.
Well, I think in Africa, the reason why is because, you know what I'm saying?
Well, it's hot in Arizona and it's spiking.
Yeah.
So Corona can't beat Ebola, so, you know. which actually, I did see a story that Ebola cases were spiking over there too. But here in the Americas, check this out now. In the Americas, so I'm assuming that's going to be North and South America, there's over 6,125,802 cases.
Yeah, that's both combined, North and South.
272,606 deaths.
That's still a lot.
That's a lot.
That's a lot.
Too many.
That's way too many.
Right. And in Asia, where the apparently in that area where it originally started, there's only been 1,132,167 cases, but only 26,808 deaths.
Well, they were ready to stop it. They, you know, when you start something, you can stop it when you want to, because you probably, you know, got a foolproof plan in place already.
Right.
If you're the one who did it initially, I mean, you know.
Yeah, when y'all, some of y'all eat this bat, we're going to get this to you.
Right? We're going
to.
I'm going to tell y'all what I'm happy about.
We're going to start it and we're going to stop it.
Right.
Let it spread other places.
I'm happy that we can go to the store and actually buy toilet paper, because that was for real. No toilet paper, no paper towels, nothing for a long time.
That was crazy. Like, you can eat toilet paper. You better be buying beans and rice.
Right.
Buying toilet paper.
But I'm already ready for the next butt apocalypse. I'm ready, man, because I've been there since Dollar Tree been stocked up. Every time I go in Dollar Tree, four rows.
You got all them snacks, too. We can go over cherries.
Yeah, right afterwards.
But you know what, Misha? I've been working on that job so long, I don't even really care.
I know, that's why I'm coming to get them.
Yeah, you don't bother with them anymore. Just keep bringing them, though.
I throw away so many bags of chips and shit and all these homeless folks out here. It's freaking ridiculous.
You know my kids are home.
Right. And the last part of this COVID report that I want to give y'all is that the part of the world who has the most minimum amount of cases is in the Western Pacific. Mm. They only have 234,815 cases.
Wow.
And they have the least in the world.
Right. So what's Western Pacific?
That's what I was wondering, too.
Is that like
Western Pacific?
Is that
got to be like the Samoans, islands.
Hawaii.
That would be the states, right?
Right. So Western Pacific, we're looking at, so Singapore and all that would be Asia and all that. Okay.
Yeah. Because when I was in Turkey, I was right by the Pacific. So it does say, it's like Australia. Damn it. Yeah, it is like Australia, China.
Okay.
So it's pretty much the continent of Asia.
Well, they knew how to get rid of it.
Well, that's it. That's it for your COVID report. Now, before we get into this story that Stephen G got, we got to get into this first segment.
He searches the web for the weirdest news stories. Comedian Damon M. Cherry wants to know, why is that news?
I like the way he made me a female comedian.
What did he say? What did he call you?
Comedian.
Comedian.
Stressed the and, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But anyway, this is one crazy news story that I saw, and I don't know if y'all saw this story. It happened maybe a few weeks ago, but on August 30th, a 27-year-old man resided in DeKalb County, Illinois. Y'all want to know he was arrested for? He got arrested. Y'all want to know what he was arrested for? He was arrested for supposedly sucking the uterus out of a woman.
Now, this was last year. You said August, so.
No, this is June. Oh, damn.
Yeah, it's July.
I meant June, my bad.
Okay.
Oh, God.
Yeah, okay.
My bad.
Thank you, Stephen.
I'm already right on.
June. It was June.
I'm sitting there thinking, I'm thinking they're going to open up in August.
Talk about the jaws of life.
Man.
This dude.
Man.
He sucked the uterus.
The uterus out.
Oh, wow.
Out.
And then didn't bother putting it back in.
She didn't know it until she got home.
Right.
And went to use the bathroom.
How in the hell?
And went to wipe. And it was no uterus.
No uterus.
But a 26-year-old woman whose name was not mentioned says that the man, 27-year-old Kion Boykin, made her feel pleasure she never felt before.
I'm sure.
I bet, right. Now, after she went home, she noticed that her uterus was missing and immediately called the DeKalb police, PD. Now, when they arrested her, Boykin, the detective said that Boykin was wearing a white t-shirt with a tongue on it that said, "I snap souls."
Well, yeah, that's pretty much what he does. I mean, the boy's a professional, evidently.
Right, and that, what Dave Spill always said, when keeping it real,
it goes wrong. Yeah.
That was one time, man.
Is there any other girls who can corroborate that story? I mean, is she alone in this?
Well, I
wish I knew him. He could have helped me out a long time ago.
I think I done gave some pleasure, but I ain't ever snatched no
uterus. That's crazy.
I'd have had the uterus come out the edge of the vagina, but it went back in.
Oh, God.
He is taking body parts.
Goodness
gracious.
That is
if you need a hysterectomy, I mean, he should have worked in a gynecologist's office.
Right,
pap smear popper.
So, Miss, you ain't never had your uterus moved around?
I've had it moved around, but
out.
not like that though, you know.
He took it out.
Yeah, he could have helped me a long time last year.
He removed it.
But that's my crazy news story. That's the one of them stories. That
well, if she was pregnant, she's not anymore.
Right. Yeah, so this is one of them stories that make you say to yourself, why was that news?
Yeah. yeah, you question if it's even true. Like, you question the validity of that.
Possibly.
Of that story.
Right, right. But that's what's up, man. So Steve, you was over there talking about the Supreme Court.
Supreme Court justices. I think the decision was 7-2. They passed down... a decision on Donald Trump, whether or not the District of New York can, District Attorney of New York can actually go ahead with charges and seeing his tax returns, right, and possibly charging him with fraud or other crimes.
So you think by them doing this, they're pretty much saying that, you know, we're not following nothing that he say.
The Supreme Court is saying initially that he's not above the law. No, right. President is above the law. He's not a dictator. He's not a king.
Good.
So they're tired of the buffoonery.
The tomfoolery. Yeah. I guess so.
And not only that, he wanted Obama's records. So what is wrong with his records being requested?
The dude said he would never play golf. That was part of his speech when he was campaigning. Right. I would never be on a golf course. This nigga on the golf course every weekend at his own golf course. So, you know, he can't.
But the question is Trump going to turn over his financial records? I don't think he will.
Somebody is shredding stuff right now as we speak.
I think you're right.
As soon as the Supreme Court came down with that decision that he must disclose them and give everything over, I guarantee you somebody's shredding stuff right now.
I'm with you.
Now, Misha, let me ask you this question. Now, you know how he always got a pretty young lady that's always speaking for him and covering up for him or whatever. Mm-hmm. If you was offered that job, could you do that job? Could you be the press spokesperson or whatever?
Press secretary.
Yeah, let's see. Money talks. I ain't even gonna lie. You know, it depends on what my situation is at the time. I'm being honest.
I mean, you'd have to lie profusely.
I would have to lie, yeah. That would be hard, though. It would be really, really, really hard.
Let me see you. I'm lying straight face.
That's the thing. I don't even really have one because I don't. You know, that's why. I don't get down like that. I'm gonna tell it like it is and get it over with. I don't do all that back and forth.
Yeah, I think those white women they gotta practice that, man. Because they be covering and lying their ass up. You can just see it all in the face, like.
Oh yeah.
But you gotta think. Where's that Sarah Huckabee girl?
Yeah,
she's
oh my gosh, she's in Dubai. She's at the vacation, away.
She's in charge of shredding papers right now.
Yeah, she probably is in the basement somewhere.
So you got a follow up on that story, Misha?
Yeah, I was just wanting to say Trump's not giving over his records, but I do want to know, would y'all vote for Kanye West?
Voting for Kanye West is a waste of a vote, and I think Donald Trump paid him.
So he could try to split the votes.
If he get 50,000 votes, that's 50,000 votes that Biden didn't get. You know what I'm saying?
Yep. So now celebrities are starting to speak out. Jamie Foxx came out and said he is not voting for Kanye West.
Yeah, cut it out.
Yeah.
Right. He said cut it out.
Cut it out. Right. And I think a lot more are going to speak up, and Kanye's going to be shut down. Sorry, Kanye. I'm a fan of your music, but.
I'm a fan of your music, Kanye.
Yeah.
I mean, it's almost as if, like, you know, you wanted to be an astronaut or something. Why?
Why?
You know nothing about being an astronaut or flying or being a pilot. Right. So why?
Right.
I mean, you know nothing about this. And just because the previous guy, the incumbent, got in knowing nothing about politics, you think you can do the same thing, but no, they're not going to let a black man do that who's not extremely knowledgeable, and I don't care whose side you're on, they're not going to let you do it, believe me.
Right.
Yep.
So go to bed.
And I want to apologize for the 2016 election for writing my name in and splitting the vote. I got 3 votes, so I want to apologize for that.
Oh, they was all family members. Don't have the family any vote for you. They're like, stop playing, Jerry. He playing, y'all.
He gonna be like, Jesse Jackson get 2 votes.
Right.
Keep hope alive.
Learn to drive. But that's what's up, man. We gonna go into another comedy break, and when we come back, We got Misha's Muses. This your boy, Damon M. Cherry.
And I'm Stephen G, y'all.
And I'm Misha.
And we'll be right back. This right back at you. Radio.
And once you get older, find somebody you can spend your time with. I've been my wife. We've been together 13 years, man. 13 long. Long. No, you don't clap. I ain't saying I'm enjoying it. I'm just serious, man. I don't. Now, you know what? Like I call it like, I am her Jay-Z and she is my Beyonce. That's how I look at it. Because, no, like, I love her to death, man. It's weird, though. Like, Beyonce, man, yo, she really got Jay-Z on lock. They came up to Saturday Night Live a couple of times, man. Beyonce is so fine. Jay sounds like he's afraid she's going to leave him. You ever hear him talk to Beyonce? Like, hey, you ready, B? Yeah. Yo, it's so crazy. I mean, most incredible, man. He didn't like me because everywhere Beyonce went, I was right behind him. He was like, yo, my man, fall back. You know what I'm saying? That's me right there. That girl is bad. Beyonce is fine. Fine, with a capital fine. You ever see somebody so fine? You feel like a stalker without a bush tie behind? That's how I felt. She's right next to me. I'm looking at her like, oh! Ooh! My wife was right next to me. I'm like, look at her, look at her! Look at her! Look at you, better get your act together! That girl is bad, what's wrong with you? Fine. You look good, man.
I just got married. Marriage is rough. Yeah, marriage is like having cable with just one channel. The same shit come on every day. Like, bitch, I love you, but shit, I want to see another movie. Shit. What's on Showtime? Bitch, please go shopping. I only like being with myself every day. That's why I smoke herb and just be somebody else. She's like, didn't you hear me calling you? Bitch, I ain't hear shit. But you got to hang around other married people. I was hanging around my boy. He been married for 6 years. The nigga videotaped his wedding day. Never watched it. Now he watch it every day. But he watch it in reverse. Because he said he loves seeing himself take that ring back off that bitch finger. Walking back down the church, just waving at her ugly ass mother down the aisle. Getting back in the limo, back at the bachelor party. Look how happy I was. I ain't smiled like this since I married that bitch. Marriage is rough. I wasn't gonna get married because I got scared. Not of the commitment, but it takes a lot to keep a woman happy now. Because when I found out Michael Jordan was having problems with his wife, I'm like, damn, if a nigga with 400 million can't keep a bitch, a brother with $100 ain't got a shot. What do these bitches really want from a nigga? Somebody let me know. I remember when you just need a good running car. Now, 400 million, these bitches too expensive. But somebody must have talked to that bitch because she took her ass back home. A real woman must have got in her head. Bitch, you tripping. You must not have been out here lately. The pickings are slim. You lucky if you get a man to buy you a drink, bitch. You better go back in that mansion and work that shit out. Come on now. Personally, I think she went out and tested the market and found out what true players know. Ain't nobody fucking with her after she been with Michael Jordan. What nigga want that kind of pressure? I mean, how you gonna satisfy and impress a bitch that had 400 million? You gonna have to take that bitch to the moon or somewhere. And you go over that big ass house, you're like, well, I can help with the electric in this motherfucker. But bitch, I only make 300, that's all I got, bitch. I don't play basketball, you better find that nigga back. You want somebody to pay all this shit. And then she got two kids, how you gonna discipline them kids? They ain't gonna listen to your ass. Y'all need to come in the house. Fuck you, nigga. This all our daddy shit. You can't even afford to pay the condo. Shut the fuck up. You make $300. Shut the fuck up in here. How you gonna argue with them? How you gonna say you better than their father? You wearing this nigga tennis shoes. You got on Hanes Breeze and shit. Got a pile of Michael Jordan cologne in a goddamn cupboard. That's why you gotta stay in your place.
Hello.
May I speak to Boogie?
Yeah, this Boogie. Hey, Boogie, this KB, let me ask you something, man. How you get out of jail before Marcus got out of jail? How y'all go to jail at the same time, but you get out a month before him and he's still in there?
Hold on. Who is this?
This KB, this Marcus' brother. Tell me how you get out of jail, but Marcus is still in there and you've been out over a month now. They say you snitching, Boogie.
Snitching.
That's what's going on. You up in there snitching.
Hold on, bro. Hold on. You slow it down. Slow it down a little bit, man. Hold up. Yeah, nigga, you know what? I really don't need to be having this conversation with you, but you coming at me like this, motherfucker. It's called bail. Shit.
How you out on bail, but Mark is still in there? Tell me that, Boogie.
Man, how you gonna call me with bullshit? You know what? I ain't finna trip with you, but fuck this. Hold on, let me pull it over right motherfucking now. You wanna know what the fuck happened?
All I know is they the one saying you the one that snitched on my brother and that's why he's still in there and you out.
I don't know where you getting this from, but I'ma tell you what. I had to go to work. I need to get the fuck out of there. But you ain't hear me. I went to jail too.
You know what, Boogie? You gonna mess around and get your ass whooped, man.
Man, what the fuck is you talking about?
You been out there snitching. That's why you out and my brother Marcus is still in there.
You know what? It's called bail, motherfucker. That's what it's called. It's called bail. I had to goddamn go to work. I don't know what you tripping on.
All I'm tripping on is that the fact that you out and my brother ain't out. He's still in there.
You know what? Since you run around here like a little bitch like he is, let me tell you what happened. All I wanted to do was go get me a goddamn beer. I jump in the car, and then I was getting your mama some cigarettes. So how you coming at me like that?
Okay,
in the car with them, and them niggas gonna start blaze up one. I tell them, nah, dog, put that out. We just going around the corner. But now, he start putting it out in the car. He throw the shit out the window. Now we get pulled over. Hell yeah, I jumped out the car, told it all. I don't got shit to do with this.
Who was smoking, you or Marcus?
I don't even smoke, dog. I had to go to work. I go to work. I can't deal with that. I told them dudes to put it out. Damn it. Law pulled over. They searched the damn car. How the hell you gonna be riding like that and law pulled over and pull you over? They pop open the trunk. You got a big ass speaker box there, back there with no damn wires on. How the hell you figure? I'm a snitch. It don't take no damn rock scientist to know you got something. You packing some shit back there. Hell yeah, I got out of there. Man, them niggas had me in that. Drinking water out of fucking toilet. Man, don't come at me like that. You wanna come in, you know exactly where I'm at. Shit.
So just cause they got you up in there drinking water out of toilet, you gonna come up and start snitching on everybody. That's why Marcus still in there now, cause you snitched out everybody.
You know what? You damn right. You damn right. Shit, I had to go to work. Hell, I used all my damn money trying to get out of there on some bullshit.
Oh, this can't be about you got to go to work. That can't be, but you got to have some heart somewhere, dog.
Shit. Coming at me like that, nigga, if you gonna do the shit, do it. Don't put me in it. I was just going to the store.
Can I say something to you, man? I want to, look.
Nah, you know what? You can't say, let me shoot you something. Since you gonna be the mailman, let me shoot you a thing or two. Tell your brother, just don't drop the soap.
No, he ain't gonna drop the soap. I'ma make sure my brother. No. Listen to me, motherfucker.
No.
I'ma tell you, dog. And I'ma tell you this shit.
What you got to tell me?
I'ma tell your boss everything about you, and then you're gonna lose your little damn job.
It can't be. You can, dog. You know what?
What you stuttering for?
I can't believe you calling me with no shit like this. Just lose my motherfucking number. Don't call me no motherfucking more behind this bullshit.
Can I say one more thing to you, man? I'ma say that and then I'ma get off the phone with you.
What, nigga, what you got to say?
This nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning Show, you just got pranked.
And once you get older, find somebody you can spend your time with.
That's what's up. We are back.
We've been together.
Oh, they got this thing. They got this thing on repeat.
On a loop.
Yeah, they got this on a loop. We gotta stop that. But we are back, man. That was my man nephew Tommy from the Steve Harvey Morning
Show,
man.
Nephew Tommy.
That was hilarious, man. He had that nigga voice so high and it never went down, boy. Stephen G, I think that's what we need to do.
Yeah, I had to get out of there. He told, didn't he?
You're right. I think we need to do some phone calls.
Pranking some people.
Yeah, we need to prank some people.
I was thinking that when it was playing. I'm like, y'all would be good at that. That would be hilarious. Could
change my voice quite a bit, I'll tell you.
Right.
Segue.
We get ready to get into
I can segue right into anything. Anything real quick.
I gotta tell y'all, I never heard segue until like 10 years ago. Steven was doing Sammy Davis Jr. talking about segue. I said, what the fuck? I've never heard that word.
Segue. What is that word?
He said, you ain't never heard segue. I'm like, no, I had to Google it.
Yeah, about 10 years ago, they had little segue motorcycles.
That just came out and stuff. Yeah. Right.
They gone.
But that's what's up, man. We about to get into our next special thing we got going on. Next segment. There you go, y'all. I had segue.
I'll help out, my man.
But we get into our next segment, and after that we got another segment called Chuckles and Knuckles. If you think you got a funny joke, hit us up at 614-781-0754. We want to hear your joke, and we're gonna let you know if you should get chuckles
or knuckles.
And I got the sound effects for both of them. It's going to be great. Oh, but that's man. What's up. So let's get into our next segment.
She's happy all the time. You never know what's on her mind. It's time for Misha's Muses.
Hey. So first I want to give a shout out to Nate Jackson. Did y'all know he opened up a new comedy club? He just opened up a new comedy club, and his first act is Tommy
who?
Davidson? Tommy Davidson, yep.
Really?
Yep.
Wow.
It opens up this weekend, so shout out.
I haven't seen Tommy in a long time.
Yeah.
Shout out, really long time.
Shout out to Nate Jackson.
Shout out. New comedy club.
New comedy club. City?
That's hot.
What city?
It is in Washington.
In D.C.?
I think so. You know, you can find the story on the Slapstick Comedy Blog.
Yeah, no doubt. You can go on Comedy Blog, Slapstick, and you can get that.
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
One of the writers just did an interview with him, and we just put it out. So, yeah, you can go in there, check it out, get to know Nate.
That's even more amazing that he opened it up now.
Booked Tommy Davidson.
Right. Yeah, that's great.
Yep.
I haven't seen Tommy Davidson since Toronto. Mm. Toronto. I was headlining Yuck Yucks, and he was shooting a movie. And he came over, and he was like... He wanted to do some time, and I was like, "Oh, I'll go, and then you go." He was like, "No, you're the headliner," and he went out there and did all of his "In My Arms" and his Anita Baker's and everything. I was like, "Man, you got to be kidding me!" But it was a good time. No, I like Tommy Davidson.
Yeah, he got a book that he put out, and I heard him on another radio show talking about. I didn't know he was coming up during Richard Pryor and all that.
Oh yeah, for sure. Tommy, I didn't know that. Long time in the game.
I don't know why. I thought you was at the Funny Bone the last time he was there. I don't know why.
I don't know if I was even in town.
Yeah, I was on that show. Me and Roda Rillers was on that show.
Yeah. So another thing that I want to mention is creativity. Michael Che and Dave Chappelle are doing outside comedy shows. I think that is completely awesome. Very creative.
That is.
And I know somebody had some tickets to one of them. They didn't want to give me one.
To Dave Chappelle's show? Oh, I would have been pissed.
Yeah.
And then I see Lavelle, he got a couple shows coming up at the
Indian Comedy Club. They didn't want to give you, man. They should have never gave them niggas money.
They should have never told you about the ticket.
Right.
Never.
Now, they put the shit on Facebook.
To quote Dave, they should have never gave.
Put the shit up on Facebook, holding them all up. So I was like, let me get one of them tickets. They flat out know. It wasn't no, I'm giving them to my sister or nothing. It was like, flat out.
None of that. Oh, yeah.
And it was a two ticket limit.
Right.
That's crazy.
But I had another comedian tell me one time that he went to one of his barn parties. Y'all ever heard of his barn parties?
A barn party?
He said he paid like $200 to go to it.
And I bet he had a time of his life.
That's what he said. He said, but out of where in his field and wherever he is in Yellowbone Park or whatever it is, where he is in Ohio, he has a barn party. And they say he just randomly do it. But my man said he went up there and... like Erykah Badu was up in there.
Yeah.
John Mayer, all the people.
Oh, yeah. There. Oh, yeah.
And
sure.
They just had a party in the barn, and they all sung and did music and all that. Yeah, he said. But
they had
said,
a great time.
But I forgot how he said he came up on them tickets, but I remember him telling me that. So I was like, wow.
Wow.
Well, what else amusing you over there?
Another thing that I am really amused of is I'm 40 years old. I got two sons. They're 20 and 22. I've been doing a lot of timeline scrolling on Facebook, and I'm proud to say I am not a grandma, y'all. I am not a grandma.
That is good.
That's a blessing. You know
that,
what?
That is very, very good.
Very good. I'm pleased because my sons do not listen to anything I say. Nothing. but they, I always told them, don't have no kids until you get married.
Yeah, because you won't get no help. Yep, so they listen to that.
Yep.
They'll listen to that.
Be like me, it ain't working.
And wait.
It ain't working.
And you think it's not working, then it does all of a sudden, you know.
47.
Work at 47.
I want to tell a story.
So he getting senior discounts at McDonald's. And so he
I didn't even sign a birth certificate. We signed the AARP card.
AARP. Uh-huh. Signing right on up. He get a check already. He get a check already. Goodness gracious.
Man, that's crazy. Man.
Yeah. But congratulations, Cherry. Yep. That is awesome.
They say, how old's your daddy? 47. Oh, son, get on in here. Damn it. Sign him up. Jimmy, sign him up. His dad's 47. We're going to never be able to play with him. That's a damn shame.
Oh, man. Oh, man.
She came out talking and everything.
Already, I bet.
Already
talking and
everything. Yeah, I'm
13
sure.
When she came out.
Yeah. I know she was talking.
Oh, Cherry, congratulations.
Oh, well, thank you.
Yes, indeed. It's a beautiful thing. I mean, you know, I was 25 when my son was born.
That's so good. I don't even want to tell how old
I
was.
I was 25. I was 25 years old.
That's real good.
So your thing was working at 25.
And I was like 47 when my grandson was born.
I hope that's how old I am. I need another 7 years.
I was 47 or 48. Where my grandson was born, he's 8 years old, and I'm 55, so there you go. There you go. All right, Jerry.
Yeah, God.
Welcome, God, welcome, God. Welcome. You got here late, but hey, welcome.
But my man, I showed up. As long as I showed up.
Now you better have the Gerber fucking insurance for the baby, and I mean the best insurance.
No, we got Globe Life, nigga.
That's what I meant.
If it got a commercial,
one of those.
If it got a commercial on TV,
you better have the best. Boy, listen.
Hilarious.
Dooney and Burke diapers. I mean, you better just go all out.
You can't straight out pull ups. You already wearing pull ups.
Pull ups already. Designers.
I seen her with her sunglasses. She put her own sunglasses on.
Put them on there. Take them out of the case and everything.
Everything already. This sun is killing. Like, what baby is that?
Okay, straight out baby food, no milk, no nothing, no titty milk, nothing. Straight baby food already.
Baby food.
Cutting her own steak right now.
She is at her baptism.
Don't even cry. We'll threaten you with cry. Yeah. Don't make me start crying.
She was at the.
I'm wet.
She was getting her baptism and taking shots of the apple juice. I mean, the grape juice.
Yeah, and eating.
She already sneaking liquor. She already sneaking liquor. You know, you 13. You was already. You sneak. You
put some on your finger. Put it on her gum.
Now she like, Daddy, give me the whole shot. But that's
you're a veteran already.
Veteran already. Any other music over there, Misha?
No.
Okay, that's what's up. So, like I said, if y'all want to hit us up at 614-871-0754.
If you got a joke,
you know what I'm saying. We wanna hear that joke from you. We gonna chat.
Let it be rated. Call on in and drop it and let it be rated.
Yeah, let's just chop it up for a minute and see.
How
if,
about that?
See if anybody called through. So Misha, as far as Slapstick, what made you want to start a magazine?
When I was in college, my major was communications, and I used to write for our student newspaper. The articles. One night, me and my friends were drunk. We had an all girls summer party. We was toe up. And one of my friends was like, you should start your own magazine. That's when my article started making front page. And I was like, you know what? That's a good idea. So I started evaluating what I'm interested in. Because at the time, I never, ever, ever watched TV. So I said, what do I like? I like to laugh. I like comedy. And that's how I came up with Slapstick. I'm going to do a humor magazine. And it's going to be called Comedy. And here we are. On radio.
It's a shame that a lot of comics started like that too, that they like to laugh and they like comedy and they didn't think about you needed talent to do this shit. Yeah. They just liked comedy and liked to laugh, so they jumped on in.
I could think of a person.
I could think of a half a dozen. I mean,
me too.
Every two or three years, you'll see an influx of comics. It'll be 30, 40 new ones.
Yep.
And then only five will stick around.
Yep.
You know, 5 years later, it'll be five of those people. So, you know, I've seen it 1,000 times.
Yep.
And speaking on it, I seen on Family Feud, it was a family from Columbus on there one time. And the dude, Steve, got to go around asking everybody what they do. So it was the youngest son. He said he was a comedian. Oh, hold on, we got a phone call.
Got a phone call. Uh-oh. Somebody got a joke.
That ring just like a house phone, too, don't it?
It did.
Ling, 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 ling. Grandma's house.
Let's see who we got on this phone. Caller, you tuned in to Slapstick Comedy Radio. What's your name and where you calling from?
Yo, this is Mike from Michigan.
Mike from Michigan.
Mike from Michigan. Up, Mike? Right on, brother.
So you must have. You must.
What up? So you go blue all day.
I heard that. I hope y'all can at least win 5 games next year.
Oh, nigga, we the best at a pinochle. We can't be beat.
The best at losing Ohio State. You call it Columbus, Ohio.
But we the chess champions. Y'all OSU can't beat us in chess.
Tiddlywinks either.
Listen, no facts.
So I'm gonna tell you. I'm gonna say, well, you shooting those jokes out. You calling in for chuckles or knuckles, huh?
Hey, it's chuckles and knuckles time for sure.
Hold on for a second.
Think you're funny? Tell us your funniest joke at 614-781-0754. And we'll tell you if it's funny or not. It's time for chuckles or knuckles.
All right, Mike.
All right. You heard it now. And then what's your joke?
Okay. Today, my son, he came to my room and he asked, hey, can I have a bookmark? And I busted into tears. Because my son is 16 years old. He still don't know my name is Brian.
Still know what?
Okay, I have the bookmark. Mark, and yeah, okay. What?
Chuckles and knuckles.
Well, what do you think, Stephen G?
But your name is Mike.
I'm on the fence. That was kind of clever.
It was kind of clever. But
get my chuckle.
But even though, when it's clever, it's got to pay off. You know what I'm saying? you didn't leave the check as in place, you know what I'm saying? With the check.
It was thought-provoking, though, Mike. I have to give you that.
I appreciate that, Steven. You know.
Yes, indeed.
Charity hating.
But this is chuckles and knuckles. You can't be on the fence. Either get the chuckle or you get the knuckle. What do you? But look, I'll put it to you.
I say chuckles.
You say chuckles.
Thank you, brother.
And what about you, Misha? I'm gonna go last on this one.
A chuckle.
You give me.
I'll give him a chuckle.
Hey. Yeah, that was clever.
All right, they both gave you the chuckles, but just to be the antagonist and the, you know what I'm saying, and to make the show different and to set the segment off of what it really is about, I'm gonna have to.
Okay, it wasn't that bad. He didn't do an hour and bomb a headlining set. Come on, right. Now. Yeah, it wasn't that bad.
I appreciate y'all letting me do my thing.
No doubt about it, brother.
Can't wait to hear from you again, Michael.
That's what's up.
Anytime.
Man. So what's your favorite radio station? What's your favorite radio show?
Oh, listen, you already know what it is. The WTMA staff.
Yes, indeed.
And Slapstick Radio.
You gotta say that.
Say it one more time.
You gotta say, and I'm Mike from Michigan, and I'm listening to Slapstick Comedy Radio.
And we're gonna take that, Mike.
I appreciate you. This is Mike from Michigan, and whenever I listen to the radio, it's always WTMH with Demonte M. Cherry.
Slapstick Radio.
Slapstick Radio.
I can't hear you. There's an echo in the background.
All right, this is what we want you to say. We want you to say, this is Mike from Michigan, and you're listening to Slapstick Comedy Radio.
Slapstick Comedy Radio?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, this is Mike from Michigan, and I'm listening to Slapstick Comedy Radio.
Hey!
Right on, brother.
Hey, Mike, with that,
we got you. We're going to play that back a whole lot. You're going to be in there.
I appreciate that.
Thank you, Mike.
And with what you just did. What you just did.
Say it one more time.
What you just did. but that other shit. Now we appreciate you, Mike.
Bad jokes get you sore around here.
Right.
But we appreciate you, Mike.
Right, we appreciate you, brother.
Up, man.
All right.
Have a good one.
You too.
All right, man. The sound effects is crazy, man. Yeah, I had to let him get the whole long beat there.
Me too.
But that's what's up. So if you're still out there, you're listening, man, hit us up at 614-781-0754. We about to go into a comedy break, and we still doing Chuckles and Knuckles.
That's right. Hit us with a jokey joke.
And then after that, we got an interview with a very famous, popular comedian coming up. We'll tell you a little bit more about that after this break. This is your boy, the Mind of Cherry.
Stephen G.
And I'm Misha.
And I'm Misha. Come on. You got to
Misha.
Be. You got to be
all the homegirls. Hang on with point, the homegirls. Give it up for yourself. Woo, woo. Woo, woo. Yeah, ladies. We hang out like we a team, ain't we, ladies? We hang out like we a tight posse. But we all got our job on the team. Am I correct, ladies? We all got our position in the posse. Like there's the hoe. You know she a hoe. She tell you she a hoe. Yeah, I had sex with him. Yeah, I had sex with him. You might not want to go out with him. I had sex. You're like, damn, you are a hoe. But that's your girl. You love her. That's your girl. She can't drink out of none of the glasses at your house. You got a plastic cup for her when she come over. You don't know where that bitch been. You don't know where she been. Y'all know who I'm talking about. The woman that you don't leave your man in the room by themselves. I'll be damned if you have sex with Charles while I'm making beef stew. Come here, Charles. I need some carrots, nigga. Yeah. She is a hoe. She is a hoe. Then we got the drunk. You can't take her ass nowhere. You give her a drink, she is messing up the whole party. She be on the middle dance floor. Hi. Hey, okay, I'm P right here. And she don't remember nothing the next day. She don't remember nothing. She don't remember nothing. What's the first thing she say? What I do, bitch? You don't remember pissing in the middle of the dance floor? You don't remember doing that? You don't remember the security guard dragging you out by one leg? You don't remember that? You know we can't go back there now, right? You know that got our pictures at the front gate now. You need help, yo. And she would drink anything. You know how you go over somebody's house and they be like, you know, I only got some vodka left. And you be like, I don't really drink vodka. She be like, pour that. Finna get toe up. Then we got the driver. This heifer drive every occasion. It don't even have to be her car. She could be high, she could be drunk, she could be towed up. This bitch line is, oh, we gonna make it home. Oh, we gonna make it to the house, we gonna make it to the house. And she could drive anything, she is brilliant, she's brilliant. She could drive cars, trucks, buses, tractors, scooters, motorcycle. This bitch can drive a camel. You open up her wallet, she got licenses. Then we got the white chick. Y'all know who I'm talking about, the one who don't like nothing. Why we come to this club? Why she got that shirt on? That's an ugly shirt. Why? Why I can't tell her? Why she gotta get in my car? Why? You be in the bathroom like, why we keep going out with her? Why? Why we keep messing with her? And the drunk be like, cause she the driver.
B.A. biceps, cause I crush the whole game. Bring Tuesday, Friday, and Lil' Charlie to train. And watch me dip their ass in gold and wear them like my neck chain, sucker. I choke you with your own sweater sleeves. You couldn't even beat me in the land of make-believe. Punk. I will Mr. T-bag you in the closest cemetery. Nobody's gonna miss you, cause all your friends imaginary.
Hi there, neighbor. I hope you don't mind if I change my shoes. I'll be rocking sneakers till this battle's over, so I don't get blood from your ugly face on my panty loafers. I like you just the way you are, one in a million. But it looks like the barber gave your head a Brazilian. I pity your neck, Mr. Gold Chains, you got too many. The only gold I keep is on the shelf in Miami. I teach a whole world full of children, I can tell. You call yourself.
That's right, if you think you're funny and you got a joke, hit us up at 614-781-0754. We're still doing Chuckles and Knuckles.
You're a 40-year-old virgin in a dopey-ass house. I get Hannibal, Murdoch, Hand-Face to stomp you out. The only pussycat you ever seen is on Henrietta, sugar. And your Mr. McFeely delivers a lot more than letters. So before you come to battle with your PBS crap, how about I call up CPS about them kids on your lap, fool?
Watch what you say. Kids love me more than lunch. I'm not the one with my face on some whack-ass Captain Crunch. When my plane comes together, you won't even see it coming. I'll chop you into four black dudes and I'll remake Cool Runnings. I'll say this once, Lawrence, I hope it's understood. Get right back in your van, get the fuck out of my neighborhood.
Hey, yeah! Holster! Yogazar!
I'm hanging out with my man, Damon M. Cherry. We always in the underground. That's the comedy underground.
Calling the Wood Cemetery. All our personnel are busy at this time. If you know your party's extension, enter it now.
Please hold while I try. The operator.
Good evening, you know my...
Yeah, hello?
Yes.
Listen, ma'am, I know this phone call sounds strange. Ma'am, I work at a funeral home.
Mm-hmm.
And I have narcolepsy. And I fell asleep in one of the caskets, and I think I'm at one of these cemeteries. And I'm calling from my cell phone. Did y'all have a funeral today?
We're closed here. And so I just happened to be answering the phone.
I know, but did y'all have a burial today? Because, ma'am, I'm at a burial site. I'm calling from my cell phone, ma'am. I'm scared. I'm locked up in the casket.
You're what?
What's up, caller? You're on Comedy Slapstick Radio. What's your name? Where you calling from?
This is Dean Melatine.
Oh, okay. This is Dean Melatine. Okay. Hold on for a second, Dean. We're going to bring you in about about 1 minute.
Okay.
All right.
How was that Edit?
At who?
Edit.
At a funeral home?
Man, I'm in the casket. I'm on my cell phone. The battery about to go dead. The last, it should still be flowers on the grave. Ma'am, I'm not...
We only had about 13 today.
Ma'am, they need to go check them, ma'am, because I'm in one of these graves and I'm not dead. I'm calling it from myself. I'm from the casket. It's wet. Is it raining today?
Yes, it is.
That's what I know, ma'am.
Okay, and what is your cell phone number?
777-93... Excuse me. 11.
777-9311.
Man, I know these niggas ain't know I ain't dead. They done buried me alive. Y'all never did this before?
No.
Ma'am, the casket had to be moving.
We don't handle the caskets. We don't do anything except when they come in here.
Well, I'm so glad they ain't do a cremation, because they'd about been burnt up. Well, can you get somebody to go back out here and just call my name or something?
And you were at a funeral home?
That's where I was.
Is that where you work?
I was. I was down there and I then fell asleep.
And what is your name?
My name is Darnell.
Darnell?
Ma'am, listen, it is dark. The only light is in here that's on my self-dream cell phone. The battery is halfway dead, ma'am. I need somebody to dig all these graves open.
That can't be done.
Well, ma'am, how am I going to get out this casket?
Okay, you give me your
hold on, that might be my grandmama calling. I can't click over. I'm scared to click over. I might lose the signal. Say what, ma'am?
Be back.
Ma'am?
If you click over, I can call you back.
No. No, you might not get a
what
signal,
ma'am.
What's your whole name? Darnell Smith.
Smith?
Yes.
What is your home number?
Ma'am, I don't have a home number, ma'am. I'm at the cemetery.
I know, but you
okay,
got,
listen.
Who do you live with?
Can you go and look out the window?
And?
Do send somebody to these graves and just see if they can hear me hollering. I think I hear somebody. Hold on.
Man, that's my man Ricky Smiley, man, with the prank call, man. You tuned in to Slapstick Comedy Radio.
An old friend.
Right here at WTMHRadio.com. Man, what would you do if you found yourself in a situation like that, Stephen G? Your phone had two bars.
Oh, man. Kill Bill comes to mind. I don't know if I could do the Uma Thurman and bust through the... First of all, it would have to be wooden to get out of that.
Right. You see the one movie where what's your dude Ryan Reynolds when he got when he was in Afghanistan or something and they kidnapped him and did the same thing.
Put
him in a wooden box. Well, that's what's up, man. This is Demond M. Chair along with Stephen G and Misha.
Yes, indeed.
And we came to the interview portion of our show. We got our guest on the line today.
Super guest.
The very funny D. Militant. What's going on, fam?
What's up? How you doing?
Oh, man, we can't call it. How's your weather out there in L.A.?
Oh, man, it's hot. I'm walking around naked.
Walking around,
man, don't stress your imagination too much, Arnold. I'm not the man I used to be.
You still got your beret on, though, don't you?
Yeah, I got my beret and my sandals, and the rest of me is naked.
That's my man. You know what this is, man?
Is this Stephen G?
This Stephen G, brother. How you doing?
Man, long time. How you been, bro?
Oh, man, real good, brother. It's good to hear your voice, man.
Man, I'm glad y'all got this going on. I'm glad I'm the first guest. That's cool.
Absolutely. We had to have somebody with not, you know, a strong sense of comedy, but a strong sense of intellect as well.
Right.
Oh, okay. Appreciate that.
A great writer and someone who can talk. That's D. Militant.
That's right. That's my main man.
Yeah, I like the way you guys have been featuring my stuff. So for you listeners who haven't been checking it out, check out the blog Slapstick.
Mm-hmm. Read D's stories because he's putting it down.
He's getting it out there.
So, D, let me ask you, during this pandemic, do you miss doing stand-up right now?
I'm sorry, say that again. You broke up.
During the pandemic, the current pandemic, do you miss doing stand-up?
No, the pandemic, I had a podcast going. I had a, like a lot of comics, I had a schedule of things I was supposed to do. And I've talked to a lot of my friends in the entertainment industry, not just comics, entertainers. No, we all pretty much got torpedoed. I was invited to do a couple of virtual shows, but they were very brand new. And I saw one, and I don't know if that's really going to be my cup of tea.
Right.
The problem that I found with virtual comedy, and I saw a guy, I'm not going to say his name because I like him, but he kind of had his camera and he was just in his living room just telling his jokes, but without an audience, there was no timing involved. So he would tell a joke and then without a response, he would say, okay, let's go to the next one. And that's not stand-up comedy. That's workshop.
Yeah, that's workshop.
That's rehearsing. And then I've seen a couple of others. Chappelle talked about the one that I saw where you had some acts and they were like in a drive-in theater. And, you know, if they liked your jokes, they would honk their horn.
Right.
Well, that ain't stand-up either.
That's not stand-up.
The virtual stand-up where you can see into people's homes and, you know, you can see the pictures on their walls and the patio furniture and their crib and all that. I mean... Yeah, it's entertaining, but it's also not stand-up. Because one comic who changed his name, this is how bad this guy bombed. He changed his name after a virtual set because somebody burped him off. You know, a comic is used to like some booze or, you know, somebody yelling out. No, because they were in the comfort of their own home, somebody just burped this burp, and he couldn't go on. He tried to incorporate the burp in his act. Man, somebody's burping me. And then the burping got louder.
Oh, my God.
So this guy, he's on the road now. He changed his name because it was that bad.
Dang, if only we can know who that is. But
oh,
I
my
understand.
God.
I think you do know.
I probably do.
Yeah, I think we do.
I don't want to say it because I like this guy. He's a really cool dude.
Yeah, really cool guy.
It was so uncool, he changed his name, and it's like, dude, that's not going to do it.
That's not going to do it.
You know, you just weren't ready to do the virtual because the guy who went up after him was very funny.
Uh-huh.
So you just kind of have to know. See, and I'm more of a social commentary, you know, and if something doesn't work, I can do a Johnny Carson and work the audience and all that and pull them in.
Sure.
Well, if I'm just sitting there, somebody starts burping me, I know what I'm going to do. You know, I'm going to attack them, you know, with fierce anger.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
furious
and it's not
going to
be nice
stuff.
After that. Yeah.
Yeah, and that's not stand-up. You know, then it's like when I first started in comedy, I used to be at a club with Ronaldo Ray called Page Four, and it was really a bar. It was on Wednesday night, and me, Louis Dix, and a lot of other people started there or worked out there. And the reason I mentioned Louis Dix is he was bombing so bad, a guy at the bar. These were old drunks. Just on hanging out on Wednesday night, he said, "Man, I give you $50 to get off the stage." Lewis put the mic in the stand, climbed up, ran, grabbed the 50 that was being held up, grabbed it, and ran out the door.
I would have did the same thing. Yeah, I would have did the same thing.
It's like, hey, it ain't going to get no better, and I'm not getting paid tonight. This is workout.
This is workout. Yeah, you'll see me again. A good leave better than a bad stay any day.
Yeah. Me and Lewis and the guy who held up the money are probably the few that remember that story. So ain't no big deal.
Yeah, I was at a Broadway comedy club in New York, and I seen Artie Fuqua. A guy was talking in the crowd. He gave him $40 just to shut the hell up.
Mm.
I was like, wow,
that's awful.
I'd have never done that.
Yeah, but he did.
I got security to get on him or something, like security.
And dude came up and got the $40 too. He's like, man, I just give you $40 just to shut the hell up.
I would have too. I would have taken it.
He should have got thrown out is what should have happened to him.
Right. So, D, besides writing for a Slapstick, are you still writing jokes?
Yes, yeah. I still write for other comics. A guy, I don't like to drop names because I don't want to. Jinx people's project.
Exactly.
But no, a friend of mine just did a film, and so he had me do a lot of writing for it. And then I've written I've written two movie scripts since this thing has happened, so I'm just waiting for word back on those. Those were both commissioned for me to write them, so it's not like I just, you know, sat in a cave somewhere and said, I hope this works.
Trying to just come up with something, right.
Yeah, somebody said, no, write this, and then we'll let you know if we like it or not, and then we'll pay you. So,
well, good luck.
Yeah, you know, this business isn't going to stop. It's just stand-up is going to be different. I've seen or I've heard about people recently who have had shows and they've had social distancing, but I don't really know how that's going to work. And, you know, you got the 2-week incubation period, so I want to see if anybody gets sick or not.
Yeah.
Be quite honest with you. You know, you can talk that social distancing 6 feet apart, but you're still in a comedy club. You're going to go to the bar. Waitresses have to come by you. The thing about comedy, and you guys know this, is it's based on energy in a room. So if you're too far spread out, people kind of feel like they're onto a little island by themselves and they're not on to the big collective, which is why we all kind of place our audiences when they come in. You try to get everybody packed together. We're all in the front, all in the middle, but you don't want them all over the place.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Now, D. Miller, this is DeMond M. Cherry, and I want to ask you a question. Now, I'm sitting there looking at your many books that you've written. We got black comedians, black comedy. We got Pimp Daddy.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that last question.
I said I'm sitting there looking at your biography of all the books that you've written. And
I just wrote number 9. It's a kid's book.
Oh, okay. So of all the books you've written, which one is your favorite and which one inspired you the most?
Out of all the books I've written, which is what?
Which one is your favorite and which one inspired you the most?
Prince used to always say whichever was the latest one that he did is his favorite. I like the one that I just did because it is a kid's book. I wrote this book when I was 10 years old, and I just found it in a garage. It was one of those writing assignments they gave you, and since I had already written 8 books, I looked at it and said, well, damn, this is a book. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I published it about a week and a half ago, and what happened, unfortunately, I had another book called Forefathers, which I wrote years ago, and that was about the American Revolution as told by a black man who, I don't want to give away too much, but he tells basically everybody's dirt, how, you know, Franklin did cocaine and who the racists and slave owners were and all that, and he was actually in government. That is probably my favorite book only because it's, even though it's a comedy, it's a historical comedy and it's a revisionist comedy, and I wrote it before Django and I wrote it before Inglourious Basterds. So it's been around a while, and like I said, it's revisionist history, so it's telling the American Revolution, but it's also telling it from the black point of view. So it's a whole different storyline versus the stuff they used to teach us in school, and I did a lot of research for it. The most important book that I wrote, though, was Black Comedians on Black Comedy, hands down.
Which one was your most challenging to write?
Because he got made into a documentary. I mean, it gave me a speaking engagement. I started doing a lot of those. I've done the Muhammad Ali Center. I've done museums across the country, universities and all that. So when stand-up slowed down, I didn't have to slow down at all.
Right. Well, that's good.
Yeah.
That's a good thing.
Speaking of books, D. Militant, one question I've always wanted to know is... the Pimp Down book with Cat Williams. Do you ever have any regrets on writing that book?
No. Good. I had a regret, I think, for 2 minutes in 2015. but other than that, no, because I know why I wrote it. And it's funny, that book was written back in 2011.
Yep.
So it's almost a 10-year-old book, and I ran across Kat's girlfriend, I guess it's still his girlfriend, and I was doing a comedy club right before the COVID hit, and she came over to me. I didn't even recognize her. I hadn't seen her in a decade, and she said, Kat wants to know why you wrote that book on him, and I just started laughing because I thought, I know he read the book,
sure.
I know he knows why I wrote it. And, you know, let me just clear it up for those who think I wrote it because I was a disgruntled employee and all that. That's really far from it. What really happened was, and, I mean, it's in the book, so I can tell you, Kat had a nervous breakdown.
Okay.
Simple as that. We had done a tour. It was the biggest tour in 2008. It grossed $50 million. I think it grossed more than that. But he walked with a ton of money, like multiple, like tens of millions of dollars. And everybody, that was the tour that really kind of broke Leslie Jones. So everybody got on her. And it was very, you know, profitable and successful for everybody. But what happened was after the tour, everybody was burned out. I came back to the West Coast. Kat and the rest of the crew stayed out, and they were trying to do dates after tour dates in, down south and New Jersey. That's what happened. Got flown to New Jersey, and bottom line is Kat had a lot of stuff he was supposed to do in California. He just really didn't want to do it. He was just burned out, simple as that. That's why they flew me in they flew me in specifically, and they said, Kat doesn't want to do this stuff, but you're a comedian, talk to him. And I said, we ain't got no language, man. What do you want me to say?
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, everybody makes up their own mind for what they want to do. Anyway, he had a nervous breakdown. Not many people saw it. I think there were about 6 or 7 of us. They were all female. I was the only guy. And he ostracized the girls who saw it because he didn't want anybody to know about it. He had a nervous breakdown to the point where he had to go to a medical center. His family signed him in. They felt he needed to take a break because he's bipolar. Uh-huh. And that's what nobody really talks about.
He has
a medical condition. I mean, it's easy to call somebody crazy and, you know, he's whacked out of his mind. He does drugs and all that. Around me, he drank and he smoked weed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, anything else, When I wrote the book, I checked with a number of attorneys, and they told me the same thing. You can only talk about what you saw and what you know.
And what you know.
You can't speculate. Mm-hmm. Because if you start speculating, at that point, it's called libel and slander and all that.
Yeah.
And so everything in that book is accurate. After he had the nervous breakdown, like I said, he ostracized everybody. The doctors and nurses were trying to find out why he went from being normal to not normal overnight, practically. And to be honest with you, what happened is he had, how can I say it, a harem.
A
few girls. Yeah, that's what he called them. He had a few girls that he had picked up, you know. Basically, I would call them groupies who just kind of hung around and did his bidding, and they ripped him off. But before they ripped him off, once he was in the medical facility, they had come to me and said, do you have any pills or anything we can give Cat to keep him awake? Because we want to go in the studio, but he's dead tired. And at the time, me and him were drinking a lot of Red Bulls to stay up, and I told him no. And even if I did, I would have still told him no. If his body is saying it's time to go to sleep, you broads ain't no goddamn doctors. Right. You pharmacists. Right. And I say broads because of them. I look at all women that way.
Sure.
But it's like, how you chicks going to come to me, hey, you got some drugs for Cat? It's like, if a cat want drugs, Cat ought to ask me.
Yeah,
for
he
stuff.
Know how to ask.
He's a grown man. He's like, hey, D, I need some weed. Okay, fine. But so I told him no. Next thing I know, he got ripped off, you know, he got signed in by his family, got ripped off. The doctors wanted to know what was going on, and they wanted us all to document. I said, no, I'm not going to tell any doctor anything. But then the bottom line is his godfather and other people close to him said, we're really trying to help Cat. We don't want his career or his life to slip away, so anything you can tell us. And I told him just what I told you guys. Them chicks tried to drug him.
Mm-hmm.
And he got mad at me for even saying anything because he's a control freak.
Yeah.
Just the bottom line.
Yeah.
He doesn't want any information out there. And I explained to him, it's like, dude, I wouldn't have said nothing if I had more communication with you personally.
Yeah.
But you deflected everything off to your doggone harem, and I was trying to help you. And
they were trying to drug you and rip you off.
Yeah. And did rip him off. And I never took a dime that I didn't earn from him. So it kind of ticked me off. So our relationship got soured after that. That was in 2009, the last time I saw him. In 2011, early part of the year, 2 years later, living in Alabama. I'm gone. And I didn't leave after just working with Cat. I stuck around for like 6 to 8 months, went through a bad divorce, left town. Went to Alabama. Next thing I hear, Cat Williams has got a hit out on you.
Oh, wow. Wow.
What? It's like, what the fuck for? And it's like, you know, he said you ratted him out to the doctors. And it's like, are you fucking kidding me? And it's like, and I heard it from 4 different sources. And that's the only reason I took it serious. At first, because I know he runs off at the mouth a lot. Most comics do. You know, I want D. Militant killed. But at the time, I didn't take it serious because I heard it. And then a couple of months passed, I heard it again. And I really didn't take it serious because I know he had said the same thing about other people. I want this guy killed. I want that guy killed. It was just like a running thing. He's in a movie now
and
he's talking about I want somebody killed.
Yeah.
So that's kind of his MO. But what happened was he started hanging around Suge Knight, so I took it fucking serious.
Right. You got to take it serious.
At that point, it ain't just your little knuckleheads hanging around trying to get, you know, Cats... Cat, you know, Jock and Cat. No, you got a serious murderer in your team.
Yeah,
now.
You can be affiliated with
him. That's why
some...
why I wrote the book. That was an insurance policy, and on chapter 22, it specifically says, I don't give a goddamn if I get hit by a bolt of lightning. So to ask God what happened, you ask Cat Williams. That's the quote.
And I'm sure our audience is curious of what book we're actually talking about. Just so you know, you can purchase the book on Amazon. It's called Pimp Down. The Rise and Fall of Cat Williams, written by Daryl Littleton. So make sure y'all go to Amazon and purchase the book tonight and read it.
And it is a good book. Yes. I mean, it's funny. I ran across people who had called me and didn't know I had written it and were asking me, man, have you heard about this book called Pimp Down? And so...
I'm the author.
Yeah, I'm the guy that wrote it. And it is a good book. I know that he read it. because his godfather called me and said, yeah, Cat just read me the whole book cover to cover. and I said, well, how do you like it? And he said, well, he's pissed, man, but he did say you're eloquent.
He did say that.
It's like, you're an eloquent hater.
Hey, but let me ask you a question. As a person who doesn't like to read long books, you got that on audio?
You know what? We were going to do an audio version. Somebody came to me. We were going to do an audio version, and somebody – oh, this is a funny fucking story. Somebody came to me, and they optioned the book. They actually optioned it, and we were in pre-production. We were going to make the movie, Pimp Down. They wow. had Nigerian investors, and as I say, this is around the time he started hanging around Suge Knight. And so the Nigerians pulled out, and the quote that I heard was, they did not want to drink their own piss. So
that was a rumor going around in Death Row Records.
Yeah, man, the Suge was hanging people out of windows and making them drink their own tea and all that.
Yeah, and all that crazy
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, so the Nigerians, they backed out, and the deal fell apart. And I'm actually kind of glad it did. I mean, here's my personal feeling about Cat Williams, and I've said it to everybody that's asked. I never had anything personally against him. However, if you threaten my life, I must preserve it. Simple as that.
As
so
simple,
I'm going to protect
simple.
Me over
yeah, you.
You
got to protect you.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm going to look out for number one, but on a personal level, outside of him, you know, kind of going off. And like I said, he threatened other people too. And the bottom line is, that was 10 years ago, and I'm still alive. So either the hitmen are waiting for me to die of old age, or they're just incompetent.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
Be in Alabama.
yeah. So I was in Alabama, but it wasn't like it was a secret where I was. I'm in a town called Sawyerville. There's only 1,700 people. You could ask one of them, and they'll point you to my house. Most of them are my cousins, though. But the thing is, most of them are my cousins, and everybody down there is packing. So I wasn't really too worried, you know, once I wrote the book. But here's the deal. After I wrote the book, I went back out in public. I wasn't hiding in a shack in Alabama. I did Monique's show. I did a lot. I did TV. I did stand up on Stars. I toured. I was all over the place, and everything is advertised with comics. So it wasn't like I was really worried.
No, right, exactly. I don't think I wouldn't have took
it. And God bless him. I mean, I got an Emmy nomination. Hell, he won an Emmy.
Yeah, yeah.
So everybody's life has moved on. It ain't like. See, and that was the second book I ever wrote. I'm on book 9 now.
Wow.
So, yeah, I haven't made my, you know, career off of Pimp Down. It paid well. Ain't gonna lie, when it first came out, everybody wanted to read that joke.
I bet.
I want to read it now.
Yeah,
I'm sure we got some listeners who want to pick it up now.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to be honest with you. It has sold, because it's a self-published book.
Uh-huh.
So I can track it, and I get paid on it all the time. It has sold every single month. Except one in the last 10 years, and that's very rare for a book.
Wow,
that's really good.
That
that's really good.
Really
I'm
good.
Very proud of you, brother.
Yeah, that's awesome.
We got the clap.
Yeah, I'm very proud of you, brother.
You know, I don't know if he is, but...
yeah, I doubt if he is.
Yeah. Yeah, but you know what? On the real about him, I've worked with a lot of comedians. I've written for over 100 comedians, and bottom line is Cat Williams is one of the most talented comedians I've ever worked with, and that includes a lot of big-name guys.
Right.
All top
right.
shelf.
He's a talented guy.
He's a very talented guy, and I say this because we had a team of writers, including me and Dion Cole and Jeff Brown and Joe Blunt, and we had somebody else. I wish I could remember who it is right now, but... It was very easy to write for Cat because you could write a line, and next thing you know, he's got three punchlines coming out of it.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yeah, right.
Yeah, and like a lot of geniuses, he's fucking crazy.
Right.
So
exactly, we're all like that a bit.
Yeah, you show me a normal comic, I'll show you a guy that should be working at the post office.
Exactly. Yeah, yeah, one and the same.
Hey, Dina, let me ask you this question, since you're talking about like writing for other comedians. And you know how in hip-hop they say when a rapper has a ghostwriter, he's more looked down as an artist.
Yeah.
Is there like a simulation between that and comedy writing as far as writing for comedians?
That's a good question.
Good question.
You're breaking up. Say that again.
I was saying, is there like a simulation the same way as for how a writer writes for a comedian are they really looked down on as having a writer, as like a hip hop artist would be looked down for having a ghostwriter?
Man, I only heard part of the question. I don't want to answer it in the wrong context.
Well,
I can hear you fine now.
Okay, this is Stephen. Cherry was asking, is there any similarity between you as a comic writing for another comic, or you know how a rapper is looked down upon if he has a ghostwriter? They'd look at him like, well, he's not authentic or whatever he's saying. Is it the same way in comedy?
Yeah. Some comics do look at it that way. However, I think the difference is if you have a heavy load and you constantly have to come up with new material.
Yeah, and you're on the road all the time, yeah.
You're on the road all the time. I think this is what torpedoed a lot of comedians. Once you do TV, that's it. That material is gone.
It's gone. It's dead, yeah.
And we didn't really know that in the early days. We thought, okay, we did our 6 or 7 minutes on Comic View.
On Comic View, yeah, we can do this
and
everywhere.
That's why everybody wants to see me again.
Right.
And part of the audience didn't see you, and they're laughing. But then you're looking like, how come everybody ain't laughing? That's a funny-ass joke. Because they saw it.
They saw it.
Because
on television.
They saw it. So as soon as you do TV, especially if you're a top-shelf comic and you're constantly doing specials, that material is burned. You got to go and write a whole new. And then the hard part is working it out. Because if you are top shelf, you have notoriety, when you go places, especially nowadays, I did some workouts back in, 2005, 2004, and they were just workouts. That's what I thought.
Uh-huh.
People had their cell phones. They posted it up on YouTube.
And everything.
Because YouTube, and people are making comments like, this guy stinks.
Yeah, judging
like,
you. Yeah.
Wait a minute, man. That was supposed to be recorded. And because I always try to pride myself when I do TV to be at my top. And then when you got this material being splashed out there. So
right.
Comedy got really... that's the way comedy should be done, but then you can go back to the old 1930s and 40s and then into the 50s. Those guys used to do those acts and stick with them all day long. They were doing for 10 or 20 years the same doggone act, and they could get away with it because you didn't have mass media like you do now.
Yeah.
Very few comics were even on TV. How many comics did Ed Sullivan? Honestly, that all the world got to see you or did the Tonight Show.
Yeah.
You could just work the road and take those jokes and kill everywhere. And once you did it on TV, done deal.
Done deal. Yeah, that's the truth. That is true. So what advice do you have for, like, young comics coming up now? And what advice do you have for, like, comics who've been in the game maybe 10, 15 years, and they're still plugging away? What advice do you have to a beginner and to a guy like in the middle of the road?
For every comic, male, female, I would say create. This COVID, I think, opened up a lot of eyes. I had a podcast and I had some comedians on, and this was right when they were talking about shutting down and people not being able to do the road and all that, and a lot of people got nervous. Rightfully so.
Yeah.
If you're looking at thousands and thousands of dollars being lost, and because you can't go get it. It's as simple as that.
Yeah, sitting on the shelf.
Right. So I would tell all comics, create and learn how to monetize what you can shoot, you know, from a video standpoint and so forth. We have to be more creative instead of just relying on we can get on stage and tell jokes, because a virus that was unchecked, because it didn't have to go this way.
No,
we had an idiot for a president.
Yeah,
so it went too far.
Yep.
And now people can't, and not just comics and musicians or anything like that, people can't go out and earn living. And if you go out prematurely, you end up in a hospital.
Yeah, we don't want that. No. We don't want that. We want everybody to be safe, safe as possible.
Right.
Well, you know, and it's dangerous because you have to be in the public to do stand-up. We could all pull out our, video cameras and all that, and we can shoot stuff, and it could be funny stuff. But what happens is stand-up comics have to now become internet comics. And the internet comics are busting up. They're laughing. because stand-up comics for a long time were very snobby. They took an attitude that they were beneath us. And I kept telling them, they're not beneath us, they're just different than us.
Yeah, different format.
That's all. I mean, funny is funny. Silent film comedy is very funny.
Yeah.
It's no more or no less funny than guys who are telling rapid-fire jokes in a movie. It's just, comics just have to understand there's a lot of different roads you can go to make people laugh. Which one do you want to take?
Right.
Let's not look down on a road saying, "Oh man, I don't want to do that kind of comedy." Well, then don't.
Well,
let somebody do it so somebody can laugh.
Well, D, we had Def Comedy Jam, BET Comic View, and those vessels, and these guys don't have anything.
That's true. They're writing in a vacuum. They're creating in a vacuum. So it's, to me, it's kind of tougher for them.
No doubt. No doubt about it.
I want to state a fun fact. Speaking of Comic View, BET Comic View, did y'all know that Gina Holland is my cousin? She's actually from Springfield, Ohio.
Really?
Yep.
Nice. Is she really?
We talk all the time.
Wow. How about that?
Yep.
What happened?
Gina Holland, she created. That's my cousin.
Oh, okay.
Yep. That is my cousin. She's from Springfield, Ohio.
Great creation.
Yeah.
Shout out Gina.
Yes, indeed. I remember when she came in the room and when I flew out to LA to do Comic View the first time, she came in the room and she got all the comics together. And she, I don't know if you remember this speech, D, or not, when they was telling us, this is not a comedy show. This is a television show that does comedy. And so forth and so on and all this. And I was, you know, we were all just looking at them like, whatever. You
know? Yeah, we about to tear
this
stage
down. We about to kill this.
We about to do what we want when we get out there.
No doubt.
Right.
Yeah, well, there was a thing where some of the producers, well, one in particular, would turn the sound down because they didn't want to hear the jokes. They just wanted to see if it would attract an audience's attention.
Yeah, yeah.
So they wanted more physical comedy than verbal comedy.
They did.
And their thing was, just make it, keep it moving, make it entertaining, and it didn't have to be as funny as comics require it to be to have a career.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they were, most of the people, I produced that show for 5 seasons from associate producer, co-producer, full producer.
No doubt.
And the attitude of the other producers, because none of them were comics. They had all went to Howard University together, the sorority and fraternity brothers, and so they all knew each other. I was the odd person out because I was writing freelance for DL, and he brought me in, and Cedric allowed me to stay because I knew him, and they said, "Well, do you want to keep this guy or not?" And because we already knew each other, we had worked the road, he said, "Yeah, we can keep D." Funny story about that is, I said, "So you want me to write for it?" He said, "Man, I don't need you to write for me. See, I got my buddy. He writes for me. I'm just going to let you keep your job." Now, this is hilarious, though. So I go on the road. He goes on the road because we're going to shoot like 6 weeks later. We come back, and I said, and he said, "D, did you ever write anything for me?" And I said, "No." He said, "Don't write nothing." It's like,
right.
"I thought you said your boy was going to write." He said, "He didn't write shit."
And I
said, "Whoa." Okay, and so we kind of got together, threw together some stuff, and saved the season real quick.
Right.
But that's what happened to DL. DL had his boy writing for him. His boy didn't do it, and that's why he ended up hiring me. So...
God works mysteriously, brother.
Yeah, well, be careful of doing business with friends. That's
that too.
So speaking of that, D, out of all of the comedians that you wrote for, who is the comedian that you're closest to this day?
Who's the one I'm closest to?
Closest with.
I would have said, if you had asked me that a while back, I would have said DL or Cedric, to be honest with you. But I haven't seen either one of them in a while. Once you, I guess you cross over a certain line of notoriety, and this happens to all comics. When you first start in comedy, you're at the comedy club, you're at the comedy hangouts, you see all your comic friends. You're almost like a
fraternity
club.
Yeah,
it's like a fraternity. And then when you start going on the road, then it's only you and two or three other comics. And then the higher you climb on the ladder, you may not even be on the road with any other comic. You may just get into town. They have a host that brings you up, and it's just you. So the higher you climb on the ladder, the more lonely, actually, it becomes in comedy. You become more isolated. So I've written for over 100 comics.
Wow.
Yeah, and I like a lot of them. This, I don't remember anybody that I don't like, to be honest with you, even though I wrote for Cat. Blue pow.
Yeah, we need a rim shot right there.
Yeah, call back. Yeah, I'm really not close with any of them, I guess, right now, because I don't really see that many comics who I've written for. And to be honest with you, some comics don't want me to ever say that I've written for them.
Right, right.
Yeah. See, I'm telling you the people that it's, you know, that's out there, public knowledge and all that. I mean, I wrote for some more, but I haven't seen her in ages, but we're cool.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh.
Because I know a super hot comedian right now who has a writer, and I now watch a lot of, I actually went on tour with them for a couple years. I still watch his, everything he does to this day, and not one time has he ever admitted that he has a writer. And I won't say his name, but.
No, he won't admit that.
You want the public to think you're that brilliant. And it's
exactly.
Because the thing about stand-up is, it has to look like it's in the moment.
Mm-hmm. Right. Yep.
Everything has to look like improv.
Right. That's it. Those are the best stand-ups, the ones where it looks like they just thought of it. You've had comics that will do stuff like stutter, and they don't really stutter. Or they'll say something like, and they don't really have to do that. They're doing that so the audience thinks they're thinking.
Right.
They know the next line.
Yeah, they're going to say, and it's a seasoned joke they've said a million times.
That's
yeah.
funny. Right. You know what? I've seen that so many times, I did not know what it was. Okay, now I know.
Yeah, yeah. We do stall tactics. We do little. That's why Chris Rock paces. He could stand there flat-footed and fire off joke after joke after joke. But the thing about moving on stage is, if you stand there and it's in a nightclub or whatever, people can turn off their attention. If you're moving around on stage, they don't know when you're going to direct your attention to them. So they have to stay. So it stays very interactive. And that's why I always try to move. I hate standing still. Because
so do I.
What I've noticed it, that you'll start hearing little murmurs when you stand still. But if you're moving around, everybody's on their toes just like you.
Now I have visions of Cat Williams running back and forth on stage.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, I did over 100 shows with that guy. Nobody leaves the room unless they got to go to the bathroom at a big theater or whatever. But nobody leaves. And I've worked with comics where groups of people will leave. That guy has been on, he did anywhere from 45 to an hour and 15. The worst show we had was in Milwaukee, and still nobody left. We just all decided it was a terrible show.
Uh-huh.
Not on us, the Milwaukee audience. I don't know what it was. They just didn't give us the love everybody else did.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, still had fun after the show. Whatever.
Yeah, it's that make us laugh audience, you know, make us laugh.
Yeah.
Yeah, hey, yeah, hey. And it was real cold, and I don't know, violence happened afterwards. It was crazy.
Yeah, sometimes it's like that.
Yeah, I like to sit back and eat popcorn and watch.
Yeah,
right.
Me too.
Now, D, we can you hear me? Can you hear me better now?
I can hear you better now. Okay. I don't know what happened to your phone, man. You got one of them AT&Ts, huh?
No, I got that Boost, man.
Yeah, that rubber ducky on the microphone.
got the cup and the string, and you're working it out.
You're working it out.
Now we started heavy with the interview. Now let's step it back a little bit and go
lighten it up a bit.
And lighten it up now. Now, how did you get started in comedy, and how did you come up with the name D. Militant?
I was working for Tom Joyner. Actually, I was working at a mortgage company. There was a guy named Greg Pittman who was trying out a comedy at the time, and he knew that I wrote funny stuff. I wasn't really doing anything with it. It was just in between selling, I would just write funny shit. And he said Tom Joyner was looking for writers. And so he gave me the information. I went down. Tom Joyner was doing Chicago and Dallas. He was flying back and forth. Right. But he had like a hub in California where he would have the writers write stuff for him, and then he would record it and ship it off, and he would play it on the show. And I went down there. I had 3 bits that I had written, and one sold, and it was the one on D. Militant, because my dad was a militant. He raised me on Dick Gregory and Malcolm X albums and
Honorable Elijah Muhammad and everything else.
Final Call, it was the whole immersion from the time I was a kid. So I never looked at it as being militant as much as just knowing what the hell was going on.
Knowledgeable, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and so I was working at a mortgage company. So I started, Buddy Lewis was working with Tom Joyner, so he said, and we were doing stand-up, but I was working at a mortgage company, so I was wearing silk suits and, you know, making money right. and all that, which meant I had a comfort zone. And the problem when you have a comfort zone during the arts is, it's like a safety net.
Sure.
I'm not advocating that you sleep in your car or at the YMCA, but if it comes to that for the art, do it.
Yeah.
We've all, every comic who's gotten any kind of notoriety has done something that's been uncomfortable or taken them out of their comfort zone where you said, man, I could have stayed working at, you know, Winn-Dixie or whatever. Yeah, but you'll never get to be anything but a Winn-Dixie manager. So
right.
you bite the bullet, you make the sacrifice, and Buddy was saying, well, because I was doing comedy as Daryl Littleton, stand-up.
Uh-huh.
Daryl Littleton was a happy guy. Happy comics ain't that goddamn funny.
Right.
So he said, why don't you just do it as D. Militant? That way, if it doesn't work out, you can just blame it on the character.
Did D say that?
The first night I did it at a club. Ronaldo Ray was there, and I got off, and it was one of the best sets I had had up to that point. And Ronaldo said, well, goddamn it, that's your act right there. Fuck that other shit you've been doing.
Damn the other shit.
Yeah, that was some bullshit. Take that goddamn silk suit and burn it. You keep that dashiki.
Keep that dashiki.
So, yeah, Ronaldo was a big fan of the act, and he was one of my mentors. Him, Robin Harris. Rodney Winfield. John Witherspoon. I was very lucky with the guys too. That were ahead of me
sure.
that gave me the time of day. And, I mean, Dick Gregory cursed me out in my lifetime 3 times. And then he would turn right around and call me a genius.
Yeah.
That was just his thing. He was just a cantankerous, mean son of a bitch.
He
and
was.
I really loved that
I did
guy.
A commercial with him a long time ago.
Okay, so you know what I mean. He'll snap it up. Man, he's a snapper.
Yeah, one of the comedians was telling me that they were at a bar and Dick Gregory walked in. And Dick Gregory walked up to him and said, hey, man, I just want to let you know you should pull all your money out the bank. And the comedian said, why should I do that? He looked at him, at the comedian, and said, Dick said, man, you must be a stupid motherfucker. I lost it. I'm not going to sit here. You must be a stupid motherfucker if you don't know why you should not take your money out the bank. Why you should. I was crying.
Yeah. Dick was hot. You know who else is like that? Paul Mooney.
Oh, I believe it.
Yeah, you can't have a conversation with Paul Mooney. Paul Mooney has a conversation with you.
Exactly. You'll sit down, and he'll do all the talking, and you'll listen.
Yeah, seriously.
And that's
if
what
you
will
say
happen.
Anything, he'll shut you down.
I believe it. I think he said
and
right
carry
after.
The conversation on. And,
no, you don't know what you're talking about. Listen, I was there. I saw what... I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, because both of those guys... Bottom line are comedy geniuses,
sure.
and they're the older generation. So you have the fact that they were actually there, that they are legends, but then the fact they're old black men.
Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. And you
oh, angry
that,
black men.
Yeah, yeah, angry black men, because they saw other comics come up after them who probably weren't as good and make more money.
Sure, sure.
And that's, you know, and that's never going to be cool in any profession. Just like football back in the day, those guys on the off season had to go sell real estate. You know, they weren't making that much money. Baseball players, too.
They had another job.
And then you turn around, and these guys are making multi, hundreds of millions of dollars. And you're like, what? He signed for how much? That would have been my whole career.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the older generation is always going to look at the younger generation and kind of say, we had it tougher or we had it better in our day or whatever, just like stand-up comics did with internet comics.
Uh-huh.
We all did that.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Oh, these internet comics, that ain't really comedy. No, it's not stand-up comedy, but it is comedy because King Bosch, I've seen some of his stuff and it's funny.
Yeah,
so I'm not going to sit here with my nose in the air talking about, well, he doesn't do what I do. I don't want everybody doing what I do.
Everybody can't do. what you do, what we do.
Thank God.
Yeah, thank God for that. I wish it was like a comedy board or a, where you had like, you know what I mean? Like you had like a driver's license. I wish it was a comedy board that you had to go in front of to keep your comedy license.
I agree with you. Because you got a lot of comics who really aren't comics.
They're not comics.
They just need the title.
Yeah.
So if that was to happen, Stephen, how often would they have to audition to keep their license?
I would say every 5 years.
Every four to five years,
just like a driver's license.
Yeah.
If you're not actively in this business, then don't claim to be. Don't go to clubs taking up space.
You're in the way.
That's true.
You are in the way.
Yep.
You're worthless.
You are in the way.
I mean, they have open mics. Go to those. Don't get me wrong. I, because a lot of comics are like, man, if you ain't a pro, you don't need to be doing this. I disagree as well. You need the comics who do the birthday parties, who do the backyard gatherings.
Yes.
You need those type of entertainers where your big name, people who are striving for careers, ain't going to do it. They get to a certain point, they're not going to do that. But you still need that.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
That.
Yeah, mm-hmm. You still need.
So you can be a lightweight entertainer, or you can say, I do comedy as a hobby. I ain't got a problem with that.
Right. Right.
But if you're going to say I'm a professional comedian, then you have to act like one. Otherwise, you make other professional, it pulls the value down of being a professional comedian.
Yeah. And they already want black, white comedy and black comedy to be two separate genres.
Right.
You know,
right.
Even though it's just one and funny is funny and has no color, it's just almost like white comics would never create anything like Snaps for white comics to come on here and talk about each other's mama or whatever, but they would definitely do it for us.
Yeah.
I mean, that's all Nick Cannon is doing right now with the rapping. That's nothing but Snaps.
That's all it is. Yeah.
That's all it is. You're Snap rapping. That's all that is. You're going to bring a guy who just made $100 million on so y'all can degrade him and tear him down and make him feel like come on, I don't agree with that at all.
I'm with you there. I don't
either. Yeah, so you can humble him.
Yeah, so you can humble him. I don't agree with that at all whatsoever.
I think what's going to happen after the revolution, which we are having right now, and I'm glad to finally see it happen, I think people are going to reassess certain things from the past that we might have done that were okay back then, but you don't want to do it right now.
Right.
Because of the way you want the race to be perceived. As far as degrading our women, calling them certain names and all that,
sure.
I think that needs to chill. I always thought it did, but, you know, like anything else, babies crawl before they walk. So if you're starting a genre such as gangster rap, and you're trying to be authentic and you're using terms that people actually do use, that's fine. But then you move on.
All right. You grow from it.
Yeah, we don't want to call our women bitches and hoes for fucking 30 years.
Yeah.
And ain't nobody else doing it. Because, that's the problem I have with it. No one else is doing it. No other race calls themselves names and records. No one else debases their women
and
records.
Yeah, and degrades one another. Yeah.
Yeah. Competition and that's all good.
Sure.
Rivalry is great, but at the same time, and I know this probably sounds weird coming from me, I'm not trying to tear down another black man.
Yeah.
And I say that coming from me because I wasn't trying to tear Cat Williams down. I had no intention of ever writing anything negative about a guy who I used to be friends with.
Yeah, until he was throwing out idle threats.
I got put in a compromising position.
Yeah.
You know, so that's how that ended up. But there's no other comic that I have attacked publicly because there's been no need to.
Right, right.
You know, live and let live. And, I mean, I feel the same way about him. Move on with your career. Live your life. And if we never see each other again, that's fine. If we do, I just hope it's a cool, you know, thing. And
reunion.
It ain't where you try to
cool
stick goons on me because I know goons, too.
Yeah. Right. Right.
Everybody knows goons.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Let's just hope it doesn't come to anything like that.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, well, it's been a decade, and like I said, me and him, it was weird because I was in Atlanta last summer, and him and DC Curry and Bo P hang out.
Uh-huh.
And I was hanging out with DC Curry, and I didn't know they even knew each other or they were close or whatever. And he said, yeah, man, Kevin lives right down the street. and he said, don't worry, I'm not going to call him. I said, man, I'm not worried about it. I mean, you have guns here. I'm not worried.
I said, don't worry, I'm not going to call him.
Okay, you asked me who I've written for, who I'm really close to. I wrote for DC Curry when he was in Comic View, and that is probably the closest comic I'm close to, is DC Curry. I have a lot of respect for him.
I talked to him. Actually, I spoke to him yesterday. He was on Bo P's show yesterday.
I love that show.
I did talk to DC yesterday, as a matter of fact.
Yeah, before the pandemic hit, we were in, Kentucky or Cincinnati? I think Cincinnati. And he told me I need to get a watch. D, I guess I went over a little bit. So, when I'm coming off the stage, he's like, you need to get a watch. I'm like, okay.
Hey, he is hilarious. That is I love DC.
He's hilarious, and he's also a very, very cool guy.
Yes, he is.
It's just that simple. That's why I can get along with him. Like I said, I hung around with him, all that. Some of the guys got a couple of ranches out there. I hope I'm not saying anything the IRS doesn't know.
Right.
And a yacht and everything else, right?
Yeah, he's out there drinking that whiskey he drinks?
We drunk two bottles of that stuff.
I forget the name of it.
I forgot too, but he's just such a cool, easygoing.
Yeah, he's a cool guy.
The first time I met him, I did a show, and it was in Augusta, Georgia, and it was part of the Creative Entertainment Tour. And these guys after the show, and I was headlining, and the guys after the show came to me and said, hey, man, you know what? We heard about you. We saw you on TV. We love what you're doing, and we want to book you on this show that we're having. I think it was North Carolina or whatever, next month.
Right.
And we want you to be the feature. And now this is after I just ripped the room, and I said, the feature? I said, wait a minute, you guys just drove 200 miles to invite me to be a feature? I said, well, who's the headliner? And he said, Don. And they looked at each other and said it like they were talking about Moses or something.
Yeah, Don D.C. Curry.
They said, Don D.C. Curry. And they said it like he was the second coming. And I was like, oh, okay, I never heard of it. And I'm thinking to myself, okay, well, goddamn it, Don D.C. Curry going to have to work his fucking ass off.
Tonight,
I'll be damned if I'm going to get, you know, struck by a guy I never heard of.
Yeah.
I went up there that night. I gave it all I had. The stage had fire coming off of it and all that. And I walked past Don D.C. Curry. And it reminded me of Purple Rain. They said, stick around, see how it's done. You know, that kind of thing. DC said, good job, man. And then he went out there, and it was like I hadn't done shit.
Yeah, and he killed. And he murdered.
He makes you forget there was even anything that went on that night. And we talked afterwards, and I told him the story, and we both died laughing, and we've been cool ever since. And I wrote for him when he hosted Comic View, and it was almost the same thing as Cedric. DC said, man, you ain't got a right. I said, I know I don't, but I don't want to get fired.
Right. So, I don't want to be
fired.
Will
you just say that I'm writing for you? Figure you're a comedy genius. Yeah, I'll tell them you write for him.
Mm-hmm. I always say two of the coolest comedians I've ever met was DC Curry and Brad Garrett. They was just
that's what I heard. Amazing. I heard that. I met Brad Garrett one time. We didn't talk that long, but I heard he's a very cool guy.
A very cool guy. I went when he had his club in Vegas at the Tropicana. He invited me backstage. He welcomed me. I sat with his family. He got a little young, cute girlfriend. Then when the show started, he let me sit with his friends. They had a little private table, and it was nice. He treated me very well. Right. So, yep, those are the two comedians I always say are the coolest. So DC Curry, Brad Garrett.
I think when comics are funny and secure in who they are, because DC Curry's thing is, yeah, he could be bigger. He could have strived to get bigger. But he said very bluntly, I like to fish and I like to golf.
Right.
Yeah.
And to me, and Brad Garrett's probably the same way, once you're comfortable in your own skin and you know what you like in life, nobody can make you wear a dress. Nobody can have you compromise your manhood. Nobody can make you coon. Nobody can make you do things because they're dangling a carrot.
Yeah.
That's probably a nasty-tasting carrot anyway because it ain't probably for you. What do you like? See, the advice I would give to comics is know who you are and what you like.
Yeah.
And I wrote a book called How to Be Funny. You can get this book or any of my books actually at funnylint.com, FUNNYLIT.com. That's got all the books. And the thing about how to be funny, it specifically tells you, know who you are. That way you know what kind of comic you want to be. Some comics are on the road and they're miserable because they don't like traveling.
Yeah. Yeah.
You have some comics that are in town all the time that want to get on the road. I love traveling, but then at a certain point, I want to stick around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Yep.
You know, so you got to know what you like and what's going to make you happy, because comedy is not a job you got to do.
Yeah. And you've got to come to the point of what you will do and what you won't do. Especially when you get out there in L.A., because, you know, like I know, D, you get out there and you could have been doing comedy for 30 years and your integrity, you're standing on that. And then they come and say, do this. And it's, you're stuck right there with the, do I go home or do I do this? I mean, it's a dilemma right there. And you've been doing this for 30, 35 years. You don't want to go home. That's a hell of a choice to make.
Well, did I ever tell you the Whoopsie Woolly story? Okay, this is an integrity story. When I got in comedy, which was like 88, 89, by the time 91 rolled around, I'd been doing it a few years, I was good enough and I went to the Comedy Store and she made me a regular. After a few weeks of, you know, having me come back and forth, she said, okay, I'm going to make you a regular. I love your act. I like what you're doing. I'm going to blow you up. Every comic wants to hear that from the chick who's running a goddamn comedy
club. Especially after being on the third stage in the back.
Right. So she says, I'm going to blow you up. And I like Whoopsie Woolly. And it was silent. And I looked at her and said, huh? And she said, I like Whoopsie Woolly. I said, what's that? That's what we're going to call you. That's going to be your name.
Whoopsie Woolly.
And I'm thinking, you ain't calling me no goddamn Whoopsie Woolly. And I said, wait. I said, Whoopsie Woolly? She said, no, Whoopsie Woolly. Just so you don't confuse it, nigga. No. Like a woolly-haired nigga with a rag and flipping pancakes. Woolly.
And Whoopsie.
So we can all come
like
and rub your head.
You're clumsy and you fall all over the place. And you're
yeah. Whoopsie Woolly.
No.
And I said, well, I can't do it.
I can't do that.
I mean, I want to get blown up. I want to get over. But I can't be Whoopsie Woolly. Yeah. I might as well call myself Boo Boo the Coon. I can't do that.
I'm going to need $100,000 right now to do that.
And I still can't do it. Because I there's nowhere I can live. Because it flashed through my head so quick. Yes, you could be Whoopsie Woolly, and then you'll be like Jimmy Walker. Who the fuck likes Jimmy Walker right now?
Yeah.
We think of him as JJ, and the problem with Jimmy Walker is he continues to live and has to deal with that shit.
Yep. You ever work with him?
Yeah.
I have to.
Did you? And did you bring up the JJ thing?
No, but... Oh man, I can't
I've heard he don't like for you to go like Dynamite. I heard he don't like for you to do no stuff like that.
Nah, hell no. He don't like that shit.
He doesn't. He hates that.
But
I mean, I think he's accepted it more than he used to, because he realizes he was a young man when he did that. He could live to be 80 or 90.
Yeah.
Dude, that's it. That's what you're known for. See, he didn't do anything else.
Yeah.
Exactly. He didn't do anything else.
That's exactly what I was going to say. Someone said they seen him in the airport with trash bags. I was like, man, that's sad.
They saw him in the airport with what?
Trash bags. Like all his stuff was in trash bags.
Oh.
Yeah.
See, and it's sad when that happens. And it happens in show business a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Because you were making, at a certain point, I don't know if you guys saw the movie Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah.
The Tarantino movie.
Yeah,
DiCaprio said it perfectly. He said, I was hot for 5 years, I treaded water for another 5 or 10, and now I'm taking that slow turn down to nowhere.
Yeah.
And that's most careers, and I point this out in my book, How to Do Stand-Up Comedy and How to Be Funny, most careers are about 5 to 10 years. Realistically, where you are making a lot of noise and you establish yourself, and then you kind of coast after that.
Uh-huh.
It's the rare performer that's constantly cranking out stuff where the new buying public is on it.
Those are usually the people they come and get, like Paul Mooney said, when they come and get you. Those are usually those guys.
Right, right? Like okay, and he's not really a comic, but like Tom Hanks. They yeah. keep Tom Hanks relevant because every movie is an event, whether it is or not.
Yeah.
Denzel, Sidney Poitier told Denzel Washington something very important, and comics and everybody should kind of think about this. He said, when you go, make the movie and disappear. Don't do a lot of talk shows. Don't divulge too much of your personal life.
Yeah, disappear.
Because then when people go see the movie, they're thinking about, man, he's having problems with his woman, and his girlfriend has got five babies. And
right.
They're not vested in your character in the film. And Sidney Poitier and Denzel have fantastic careers because of that. Wow. You can't let people know too much about you, whereas in comedy, it's almost different.
Yeah.
You want people to know a lot about you, but what you're presenting, not necessarily every little problem that you have
every
in your
nuance.
Real life.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't care about all that. Right. I mean, I'm Dean Militante. You want to hear me talk crap. You don't
That's
want
it.
To hear
if
it, I
yeah.
have problems with my kids or anything like that, unless it's relevant and funny.
Yep, right. That's true.
But D Militante, we're going to ask you a couple more questions and we're going to wrap this thing up because we ain't on
okay.
We ain't on L.A. time.
Yeah, man, no, the sun's still up out here.
Right. Right. Yeah, I know. Yeah,
and man, man, this has been a great interview, man. We've learned a lot from you and learned a lot about you. But let me just ask you a simple question. And what's one thing about D Militante that you normally don't tell people that nobody knows about you?
Okay, you broke up again. Translator.
He said, "Okay, he said, what's one thing that you could tell us about and tell our audience about yourself that no one knows about you?"
Ooh. I'm happily married and I've been faithful to my wife for 10 years. And the only reason I say that, and a lot of comics would be laughing, with my first marriage, I was married for 20 years, and I cheated every chance I could get.
Yeah.
So
yeah, we had I remember we was in the room, your room, with some
yeah. I mean,
a crowded
that
room.
That was the comedy boom day.
No doubt.
And we all were treated like rock stars.
Yes,
and we
indeed.
Acted like it, and I guess that would be it. I mean, I think most entertainers are kind of like, you know, backsliders when it comes to that.
Yeah,
and, sure. Yeah, so that would be it. I'm happily married now, and I have no desire to, and I've had groupies come up at me, and I've said no. And that's a tough thing to do.
Right. Yeah, it is.
You know,
I second
all of a sudden
that.
There's a nipple by your eyeball, and you're saying, nah,
no,
I'm a woman home.
All right, man, and we're gonna ask you this one last question now. Can you hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay, now this is a question that I ask everybody. Even when I do my hip-hop show, I ask rappers, I ask anybody, but I just flip it to whatever they do. Now, we know you're a comedian, but I want you to take yourself out of being the mind of a comedian and go into the mind of a promoter. Now, you get to book the all-time ultimate comedy show. Who do you got on this show as the MC, the opening act, the middle act, and the last act, and it can be past or present?
Okay, now this is all time. People who are actually dead can be on this, right?
Yes, past or present.
Okay, so because I don't want to talk about anybody present because I'm going to miss out on somebody. I would have Richard Pryor and Rodney Winfield co-headline, and I would have the opener probably be Witherspoon.
Oh, yeah, that would be a great show.
Yeah, and I would have Robin Harris as the host.
Right, right. I was about to say, yeah.
Oh, yeah, you're making a lot of money that night.
Robin
that should
Harris
be a tour
hosting.
Right there.
Yeah, yeah, that's a real OG show there.
Yes, indeed.
And if you wanted to throw in somebody else as a guest spot, Bernie.
Bernie Mac.
Bernie Mac.
Bernie Mac.
I'm about to go kill myself just so I can see this show.
Bernie
so,
Mac, it was
yeah.
good talking to you, brother. Oh, my goodness, man. Yeah.
So how can everybody reach you on the social media if they want to get the books or anything like that? How can they reach out to you one more time?
Yeah, go to funnylit.com, funnylit.com. Basically, all the information about me is there, bio and the books and so forth. And once things get back to normal, then I'll be back to posting a schedule. Versus just saying what I'm doing, because I'm doing Zoom speaking engagements now. I've got some stuff coming up.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Yeah, I've got the Fort Lauderdale Book Festival that's coming up on the 18th of this month. And then on the 23rd, I have a Zoom speaking engagement I'm doing.
All right, man.
That's amazing.
All right, brother. Well, God bless you real good, brother. And it's good hearing from you, man.
Thank you guys for having me on.
Yes,
it's been a lot of fun.
Well, thank you.
And hopefully I get some sales on that spike on that cat weed.
Oh, absolutely. Hopefully I'm almost sure about it.
That.
Indeed, I do definitely want to say I appreciate all of the work you do for Slapstick Comedy. I definitely appreciate you.
Hey, and thank you guys, and look forward to my next op-ed. It should be pretty powerful, too, trying to keep up the quality.
Okay, brother, for sure.
All right.
Hey, before you go, can we get you to do a liner for us?
Yeah, what do you want me to say?
Just say, this is comedian D. Militant, and you listen to Slapstick Comedy Radio.
Okay, let me know when.
One, and put some stank on it like they told Chris Rock.
Okay.
You just go at any
time.
All right, anytime?
Yeah.
What it is, brothers, sisters, and the rest of you, this is comedian D. Militant, and you listening to Slapstick Radio.
That's what's up, man. We take that. That's good.
We'll take that, brother.
Yeah.
It's okay, good to hear from you, man.
Right.
Much love to you. God bless you real good, brother.
Hey, have a great summer, and keep your mask on.
Yes, sir. Peace.
All right. Peace.
All right, everybody. That was the comedian D. Militant, man. That was such a good interview. Were you going to the bathroom?
Yeah.
I'm about to close it out.
Come on.
I got to edit all this out anyway. So yeah, but man, this is a comedian Demond M. Cherry, man. We want to thank y'all for tuning in.
Thank you all.
Radio. You can catch us each and every Thursday from 7 p.m. to 9 p.m. And you can follow me on all the social media at Demond M. Cherry on everything.
ComedySlaps.com and Slapstick. ComedyWordPress.com.
And it's Stephen G, and we're signing out. We'll see you all next time. Thanks for listening.
Peace.
Thanks for listening to Slapstick Comedy Radio. Join us Thursday from 7 to 9 p.m. at WTMHradio.com. Check out our blog and all things funny at ComedySlaps.com.